Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast, and as of release, the penultimate edition of the SWN podcast. There's only one more left, and it's the quiz. So this is technically the last interview that I possibly will do for the year, the foreseeable future, while I go off and be a grown-up and look after another mini-human, which is a terrifying prospect. I am joined once again by Aspen Faith. Welcome back to the show.
Hello. Eating some cranberries.
That's the ASMR kicking in.
Cranberries, yeah. To be fair, I've put the wee bag of it right next to the microphone, so you're probably going to hear it rustling.
That's all right. It just speaks to the SWN podcast that I'm not going to try and even hide that. It'll just be rustling away as we go on. As long as we get through the whole episode without my internet dying in the middle of it, I'll take that as a win. So it's all good. Right. First question for returning guests is one I asked you before we recorded, but how's it going?
I'm alive. Same answer you got before
we recorded. Yeah. It's just a case of just weeding our way through at this point in life. It's so we've got loads of questions. We've got like so many through the Twitter. We had about 20 questions in total between everyone, 20 replies anyway of varying oddness.
I think what you should do is just, did you say you had notes?
I say I had notes. Pretty much I've got the cage match up and I've got what your most recent matches were since we last chat, which was all.
Why don't you do a note, and then a couple of questions, and a note, and a couple of questions, and then we'll
mix it up a little bit. Cool. All right, so we'll start with some bit more, I suppose, cliche when it comes to podcasting. So when we last chat, it was way back in episode something, which I didn't write down because that would be a handy note to have. It's been a while anyway. That's pretty much the gist of it. I think it was around about this time last year. So there was no shows at that point. There was nothing at all. There was nothing at all. We were all just kind of waiting for stuff to happen.
Actually went and looked back this afternoon to make sure that I wasn't wearing the same clothes. but I noticed that last time and this time, you've put the Lost Boy. I've never been the Lost Boy. I'm always just Lost Boy. Twice now you've done that.
Well, thankfully for this episode, I'm not putting Lost Boy in at all. I've came with a nice witty title of, I think it would be nice because, Faith. And that's the thought process when it comes to name titles of these podcasts.
Give me 2 seconds. I have a cat scratching at the door.
So I've been dropped by a cat. Cool. I did have a wee look at the last episode as well because I try to rewatch them if I have time during the day, which I didn't today because today was just mental work wise. But I made sure that I wasn't wearing the same thing also because I thought that's just a bit weird. And I was going to wear an Aspen Faith t-shirt available online if you contact Aspen Faith, but I thought that may be a bit like super funny and super funny. Yeah, that works out. Yeah, that works fine.
You were wearing an Aspen Faith t-shirt last time.
I know, but I think I've matured since that last chat. Possibly, I'm thinking I don't want to be like number one fan with the wee foam finger just going, yeah. Yeah,
that's what you are.
I know, but don't say it out loud. So since then, since the return, I've got a dog at the door. This is animal related in general, right? So since then, no shows happening since we last had chat. That's where we're going with. Since then, of course, you returned to the ring. Said since then too many times, and what was it like just getting back out there when you're able to actually get back in front of a crowd? Were you just excited? Were you
horrifying? It was awful. Genuinely, it was awful. I think only just now I'm kind of starting to feel okay again. I went into lockdown the first time I was £215. And then my first match back was with Ian Skinner, and I was 242. So it was a harrowing experience carrying around that body weight, still trying to wrestle like I was a young buck, you know what I mean? Which is why I wrestle completely differently now.
And coming in with Ian Skinner as well, who's like, very fast, very, very energetic. And I mean, it was Disco, of course, Disco is back. I watched it on the YouTube. It was very, very different Aspen Faith. It was more heavy. It was heavyweight Aspen Faith. That's what it was.
Like, I've basically just cut out as much running as I can. And it's just strikes and power moves. I still don't mean salt, though. But
certainly do.
Yeah, it's just, it was horrible. It was honestly horrible. I think now I'm starting to be more comfortable with it. Part of me is kind of glad that I got hurt at the end of the year. Not like I was going to be wrestling Mark Haskins, but I got hurt the day before. Nathan North did a suicide dive out of me and just landed knee on back of my hand and broke my hand. And it looked like I had two different people's hands for about a week because it was just so big. But I had to pull out the Mark Haskins match, which I'm wrestling him next week. But I think I'm more prepared now for it because I've wrestled at this size now for like almost a year now. So I think if I did it then, I might have just died in the ring.
So was there a conscious decision to kind of do that? Or was just that's what happened and you decided to work with it?
Half and half. When we did the first lockdown, when we came out of it and gyms started opening for a bit again, I was like, right, I'll get myself into like good shape for when shows come back. Because I was thinking, like, Discovery had announced a show for like, I think it was the July or something. And I was like, right, that's when I'll be back. And obviously I wasn't back until the November the next year. But I'm in my head, I was like, right, that's like 3 good months to just get in shape. And then everything closed down again. And I was like, fuck. I was like, right, shows will be back by like end of the year. So I did Insanity for a bit. I lost loads of weight. And I was like, emaciated little like skinny boy. Because in my head, I was coming back just wearing trunks. Like no t-shirt or anything anymore. And then everything shut down again. And there was no shows. And then I was just like, at that point, I was just sick of life. So I just ate. But I was eating, but I was like lifting at home and stuff. So by the time it came round, I'd put on like almost 2 stone, but it wasn't like all fat. Mm-hmm. So like I've got bigger on my shoulders and my chest and all that. I've still got a belly on me, but I don't think I'll ever not have a belly, to be fair. But yeah, I got back to training and I was like, this is horrible because I'm not used to, I'm trying to move the way that I used to. I'm trying to wrestle the way that I used to, but I'm having to carry an extra 2 stone. And it was the worst.
Was there anyone that you kind of like discussed with? Because of course I've seen there's so many, a few wrestlers nowadays that have kind of bulked up and then adjusted accordingly, like Andy Wilde and Damo as well being another example. Was there anyone that you kind of sought the advice of to kind of just
much specifically? Like there was people like after shows and stuff where it'd be like BT Gun a couple of times and watched one of my matches and he was like, you should be you know, wrestle more like this now because you're much bigger. Like I wrestled Caleb, Reckless. Obviously, Caleb's big, jacked guy, but like standing next to him, like I'm a good bit taller than him, and I'm also heavier, so I looked huge next to him. But I was letting him like bill me corner to corner across the ring, and because I was still in my head, I was still Kings of Catch, Aspen Faith, little doing flips and stuff. You know what I mean? So just people being—it was more people being like, "You should. You're looking huge now. You need to start wrestling like a bigger guy." So it wasn't really completely changing everything I'm doing. It was taking stuff away that I didn't really need to do anymore, and focusing more on like the strikes and then like any of the power moves that I can do. So I've been wanting to wear a singlet since like 2013, and I kept getting told no, but now I'm big enough that I look good in a singlet, so I'm fine. So no one cares anymore.
So it's one of those great weird things. Yeah, if you're skinny and you've got a singlet, it looks odd. And then
yeah.
But at least then when you bust out the moonsault, it makes it even more impressive that it's a guy that's bigger.
That's what I've been saying to folk. Like, I want. They're like, who do you want to like wrestle like, sort of thing? And I've always wanted to wrestle like Chris Hero. Like, he's always been. So now I'm in the mindset of like when Chris Hero got released and he put on all that weight, but he was still doing like cool flips every now and then. So that's the kind of thing. But then at the same time, I kind of just, from when I was like 10, I fucking loved Hugh Morris. So like, I kind of just want to be like a less problematic Hugh Morris. Just big guy in a singlet, moonsault.
Fair enough. As soon as you said Hugh Morris, I was like, yeah, maybe not the outside stuff, but you know, a little bit of huge erection every so often, just busting it
just,
out there.
No, I just want to be singlet, big heavyweight singlet guy doing a moonsault. I don't want to be like naked stink face and trainees and shit. I'm not going that far.
I know. I think most of them got outlawed in 2020, but you know, that's another story for another podcast. So you go back into the ring. We'll dive into some questions. Then we'll do that. We'll do a story and then do a question. That seems to be the best way to go about these things because there's so many and it's great. I think we did this chat before. Maybe got like four questions or something like that because I think folk were still unsure of my style, which is no style. Right. Let's just go for a nice simple one. Favorite Swift moment. So that's from Scotty Swift.
Favorite Swift moment? I don't know. Obviously, I've wrestled Scott loads, but Scotty, gotta give kayfabe name Scotty, not Scott. I've wrestled him loads, but like, I don't know. I don't think we've ever had like a match that properly clicked. Like, we've had a couple of matches that I thought were good, but like, and we've never had like a match that I just thought everything worked well. And I kind of want to do that at some point, but I don't know if that will happen because now we're both goodies. So, I've wrestled Crusher loads and Dynamite loads and that, and I've had matches with them that I felt like really worked, but I don't know, something about just the styles that me and Scott wrestle, I don't think it always clicked in the ring. I think it could now because like I'm not an immature little shite, and I think I've in ring wise, I know what I'm doing now compared to then anyway. Favorite Swift moment though. It's hard. I'm trying, because all the stuff with me and Scott is just speaking absolute shite, which a lot of it I probably can't repeat on here. I mean, I probably could, but I don't know if. But I'll need to think about that.
So we might circle around yeah. that one towards the end.
I remember I gave Scott a black eye. It was me and Midas against him and Jay Lethal. I don't know if you were there. That was before your. Have you ever seen that match? No.
I have seen it. Because I think I had it on DVD. I have it on DVD somewhere, maybe.
So the finish was gonna be, there was some sort of distraction. Midas gets a chain to me, and I wrap it around my hand. I'm going to hit Scott with it. 1-2, it gets broken up or whatever. And then I miss the swing on Lethal and get done for the finish or whatever. But I'd never hit anyone with a chain before. I was like, I'll be fine. But I'd never hit anyone with a weapon, I don't think, at all at that point. So I get the chain, I wrap it in my fist, and I just wham. Just straight into like his eye socket. I was like, oh crap. But it was a learning experience, and I never did that to anyone again. But I just remember the next day at training or whatever, or the next training session we had, Scott just had this like black eye, and I was like, whoopsie. And he told me to do it, so.
Oh yeah, so
it was his idea for this. Yeah.
But well, speaking of matches that you've had, I think you had one in Fraserburgh. I was there for that one.
That was the one. That was the first match after Midas left. Because I was wearing all black. That was one of the moments where. So, what I do is, if I feel like I'm getting stale or something needs to change, I strip away everything and just start fresh. So when I first started, I had like tie-dye flares and shit like that, and then I wanted to change it and make it more like a more serious sort of character, so that's when I got black and white tights, and I had the white boots, and I just had long black and white tights. And then that evolved, and I eventually went into like trunks and stuff, and we went the Team Smash stuff, and then he left. And then I just got a pair of plain black trunks, black knee pads, white boots. That's when I added the armband. The black armband that I wear, that's my morning band for Midas. That was the joke. It was only meant to be for one match. It was meant to be like, you know, when you go to a funeral and you get like a black armband. It's like your mourning band. That was my one for Midas. I've just kept it for 10 years. But I got just all black. And then I just got the tights, the black tights with a white Aspen on the back. So there's black and white. And that obviously went and evolved. And then when we started the Kings of Catch stuff, we got the black and white shorts. So again, I just stripped away all colour and stuff. It was just black and white. And then that kept going. And now that I've went a singlet, I got a black and white singlet just to start fresh again. And then the pink in the singlet is the first time I've added something to it. But every time I feel like I need to change something, or it's just getting a bit stale or something, you know what I mean? It's like a different like stage in my wrestling. I just take away all colour and stuff and just make it black and white and just let stuff evolve from there.
We were speaking about the singlet. To go back to, we'll get onto the triple threat properly at some point. I'm very much sure of it. But it was like when Stone Cold Steve Austin came out at WrestleMania this year, and he had his knee braces on, and I was like, yeah. Oh my god, his knee brace! He's got his working knee braces on, and I was so excited. It's like when I saw you just before the show started, and I saw you were in pink. You had the pink like flare to your gear. I was like, oh, yeah. We're in for something. Well, I knew I was going to be in for a good match anyway, but it was like something about that, seeing the pink and black again. I was like,
yeah,
oh, something's happening. Something.
I've got another set of gear that I've not wore yet. I'm saving that for a special occasion if it ever happens. But I've got a good it's another one that's like, oh, you know, when I walk out, it'll be a, oh, shit's going down. Mm-hmm. So I've got something, but I won't say what it is.
I know, every time I go to, well, I feel like I'll get to the main shows. I'm hoping to get to Nations, but then after that, it's, who knows. But yeah, it'll be a case of when you come out, I'll be like, oh, something different. And if it is, I'll be like, oh no, get the old, make sure I'm sat down. just be careful. And yeah, so it's just something about it.
Just take the baby to shows.
See, that is my plan.
That Fraserburgh match with Scott you mentioned,
mm-hmm.
I got a complaint after the show, an email complaint.
Okay.
Because a woman brought her baby to the show. And me and Scott fought to the floor and I threw him into a wall. And then I asked her if I could hit Scott with her baby. And I thought that was hilarious. But I got, WrestleZone got like an email a complaint because I suggested using their child as a weapon. Don't bring a newborn to a show if you don't want it involved.
Yeah, now you've put me off the idea a little bit. Hopefully Nations, and then of course this is due at the end of August, so I'm like, Nations is scary enough as it is, but Vago keeps pointing out
that Halloween's off the card. Christmas
Halloween's Christmas, probably.
That's just a wee Christmas treat for you
know. I know, but it makes it worse though, because your match of Halloween is going to be you and whoever the champion is, so I'm like, oh well, that'll be, if there's going to be one that you win the title at, of course there'll be one I can't go to. That just seems to be my kind of luck. Because I think there was a stat I had at one point that every time I went to a show you were on, you lost.
To be fair, I lose a lot.
Yeah, but I think the only time that changed was like when you won the Tri-Counties. I think it was one of the first times I actually saw you won a match.
I don't lose a lot. I don't win a lot. Have I won? I think I've won once, maybe twice since I started. Back after the pandemic,
I beat
Stephen Miles.
Yep.
And
Nathan North as well.
There you go. I think that's it.
Yeah, and I mean 2.5 wins because you're co-winner of the Rumble as well. There you go, Rumble.
That's a draw.
Co-winner. I'm gonna just put co.
It's a Rumble, so it's okay.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah, that's it. I don't win.
But no, you've had a fair few matches since you came back. Then we'll again do our match thing, and then more questions. But one of them. So you had your match with Ian, DQ, and then your match with Aspen. He says that was the one that you broke your hand.
Nathan North.
Yeah, that was that one, wasn't it? Yeah. And then you were down to Liverpool again for TNT. So. Yes. Two matches in, you're kind of readjusting to this new weight and everything. Yeah. And you go down to TNT in an extreme division match. So I'm assuming there's it's a little bit more than dropping in that. There's probably a bit more weapon involved.
Yeah, there's tax, a powerbomb that got out of some VHS cassettes. I got my hand stuck in a VHS player and slapped him with it. But yeah, I think that was that. And then I don't know if it was on cage match because I don't think it ever went up. I did DOA for them in February as well. Tournament. Deathmatch tournament.
It's not. So were you finding it with this new...
I did two matches, broke my hand, and then did three death matches. And then had another match again. So it made no sense trying to get back. But to be fair, I think those were easier because I wasn't having to like, there's not really much running spots in a death match, to be fair.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that I got through them all easier. It was the death match with Rory Coyle, which is that one I think is on there.
Mm-hmm.
And then DOA was Chairs and Tax against HT Drake and then Taipei Deathmatch with Clint Margera.
There you go. Nice easy nights. Well, like I said, you don't have to run. But did you find that with that extra weight, there's a bit more when you're hitting tacks and that? Was it better? Was it worse? How did you find it?
I've never found it a problem anyway. I've got quite a high threshold of pain. The tacks are all right. I don't mind tacks. Barbed wire is not great, but I'll deal with this. Yeah. The worst, no matter what I've done, the worst chairs every time. Which is why I tend not to take chair shots. I take like bumps onto open chairs and stuff because they fold and it's easier on me. Like I did the, I don't know why I keep doing it, I got the fucking chain of death, the cup monster cans on the chairs. So I take a flare bump off the top through two chairs with that on it. That sucked. But all the stuff in those matches, like the Taipei is obviously the reverse tape with broken glass on the fists. So that's, you know, you jab someone in the head, you're bleeding. It's not much I can do with that. The worst thing that I've taken since I came back was the chair shots from Dynamite. By far.
Yeah, that was like so uncomfortable to watch.
Like, forgetting kayfabe or whatever, right? Like, I've known Dynamite since 2011. And like, I fucking love Dynamite, but he can't throw a chair to save his fucking life. It was every single one of them killed me. Every single one. And then he hit Damien with like the back side of the chair. But you're like not the flat seat side, the sharp. So he hit Damien with the wrong side after he just killed me. And then what was it? He gave him like a DDT onto the chair or something and like bust his own elbow. So it's just, that's genuine. So since I came back, I've had three death matches and the finish of Anarchy was worse than anything I did in those matches. By far.
So it's still a glutton for punishment.
Yeah.
Regardless.
The best thing in those matches was the Nerf gun I made. I'd modified a Nerf gun to shoot bullets with tacks on the end of them. I got them shot into my legs, you know, like Ace Ventura style.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the kind of stuff I like. I can't be arsed with just this, like, everyone going in and throwing light tubes and that. It does nothing for me. Like, the DOA tournament, our match was chairs and tacks. So we only use chairs and tacks in like different creative kind of ways. But like some of the other matches was like whatever the stipulation was, barbed wire or I don't know. One of them was a home run derby match, which is just different kinds of baseball bats with stuff on them. It was like a baseball bat with tacks, a baseball bat with one had like barbed wire around it, one had, you know, them little popper things you used to get at school, you would throw on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And they'd go, psh. They had them on it. But I think the first thing they did in the match was throw light tubes at each other. So I was just like, okay. But that's, I like death matches. I like hardcore matches, but that's not for me. Like, I don't see the merit in every death match on a show involving light tubes.
Mm-hmm.
Like if you've got a stipulation, use those weapons and then save the light tubes for like the final or something.
Yeah,
that's how I see it anyway. But
yeah, like you approach like a match two ways. One, creative. So it's like you think, right, I've got these two weapons. What can I do with those things? And then their side of it being logical. It's like, because like you're saying, if first match is whatever, tacks and tables, we'll say, and then everyone just use light tubes, and next match is the exact same thing. It's like,
there's no build to the final.
Yeah.
If the final's going to have light tubes, I think the final had like light tubes around the ropes like that. So if the final's got light tubes around the ropes, what's the sense of me doing light tubes in the opening match? Now their match doesn't have... Now they can't have a moment in the match where the first light tube's used and it gets that big bang and everyone's like, oh, shit. Because everyone else has used light tubes every round. So, I don't know. That's just me.
Okay.
Oh, one day I will do a deathmatch tournament in Scotland and it'll be quality. You'll be there. Front row, goggles on.
Yeah, I was going to say, definitely with the whole... I'll bring my own. It'll be fine.
They are my favourite people at deathmatch tournaments, the people that sit in the front row with, like, goggles and stuff on, just in case. That happens a lot. I like that.
Yeah, but I like they're prepared. That makes sense. Cause I generally don't like being front row because I get a bit too close, and I'm quite happy just to have, like, a barrier of people. Unfortunately, for things like if I'm going with Kyle and Kayleigh, is they're front row people, so I'm like, ah, oh, fuck, I'm front row. That's just happening. But yeah, otherwise, I like to have a barrier. So if something happens, I'm like, fuck, no, you're first. you could die before I do.
Yeah.
So that, I think that explains why it was funny, because during the Anarchy match, we'll just get onto that now, because we spoke about that match. But yeah, you were pushed into me, and my automatic reaction was just like, cover. Like, I wasn't helping you.
Yeah, I didn't know what was going on at that point. I turned around and I got shoved, and then I was sitting on your lap for like half a second.
I know, it was like my gut reaction of no, go away, don't want you on me. Back you go. Right, let's speak about like that. We'll go Rumble and then Anarchy. Okay. So we'll return Rumble Anarchy. That makes most sense. So beforehand, you were putting up little teasing pictures on the Twitter of the venues when WrestleZone returned, which of course
I started doing that before I even knew I was going back. I was just fucking with people.
Two people in particular, I think, were getting a bit on edge about it.
It wasn't directed at anyone, but yous were, you were taking the bait.
Oh yeah. Oh,
I started putting them up. I put it up at the first one I did was the Halloween one, I think. And I did it at the Halloween show, and then I did it at the Christmas one. And I done it. So, how many shows did they have?
So we've had Halloween, Christmas, Ellen.
Right. Yeah. And then, no, that was after Summerhill, because I'd already returned by Ellen. Yeah.
So you had. Yeah. I missed.
There was another one. Maybe one at the Academy or something. But I just started like posting pictures of the venue, just to like fuck with people. I hadn't even spoke to them about coming back at that point. And then you just kept biting, so I just kept doing it.
Yeah, pretty much every show was like, when is it something gonna happen at the end of, because initially we thought you were gonna come out at the end of Hijinks, because between Brad and Damien was the initial main event, so I'm thinking, oh, you'll come out at the end of that, I'll be amazing. And it didn't happen. And of course, yes, you did it for Chaos, and I wasn't at Chaos because I was the idiot that went to the show in Elgin instead. And I thought, I'll be the again, that'll be the time you'll come back because I want to be there.
Yeah.
And then, yeah. And, oh, Jesus, the reaction. How did you feel when the reaction happened? Of course, you came out, lights went down. Well, someone switched them off. You came out dressed like you are now, but with a towel over your head. So,
it wasn't a towel. Come on, it wasn't a towel.
Was that a narrow t-shirt?
No, it was a scarf. It was a headscarf.
Scarf.
It's a big scarf. You know, I was trying to look like Aleister Black.
All right.
I was like, the day before, I was like, what am I going to wear to make this, like... Because I didn't know I was getting the lights off until I got there. And I was like, is there any way we can turn these lights off? We figured it out, but it wasn't very dark. But I think it worked all right because the lights had been on all evening, so everyone's eyes hadn't adjusted, obviously, so it was fine. But I was just like, well, what will I wear? I was like, fuck it. I'm going to wear like the most Aspen Faith outfit in the world. I'll just wear black shorts, an Aspen Faith cutoff t-shirt, and bright pink high tops. It wasn't subtle, but
the best thing about that though is ADM messaged me like when the footage went up, because you were saying that it was, you looked the most Aspen Faith, but everyone still waited for you to take like the scarf off your head before they went wild. So yeah, what was like getting back? What was that reaction like for you? Did you feel like it was like, yes, it's cool to be back? What was it like?
It was weird at first, because I've never been a good guy at wrestling ever. like before, I'd been saying to Scott, like, I don't think folk are gonna want to cheer me because I've always been a bad guy at WrestleZone. And he was like, no, it'll be fine. Like, okay, whatever. And then, yeah, once the lights came up and I took the like scarf off, there was a minute where I was like, folk are obviously like shouting or whatever, and I'm just like, this is weird. I don't know if I like this. Like, I don't know. Like, the only time I've ever been a babyface was Team of Lewis. That's it. I always just thought that was because people liked him, so they cheered for me as well. Mm-hmm. So I was like, this is weird. And then I started like battering folk, and that was when I was like, this is cool. Like, I like this is cool because I'm not just like, it's a weird thing, like the difference between coming in and like jumping someone and battering someone, and everyone's like calling your names, and like you get that like buzz of like adrenaline because it's like, yeah, you fucking hate this, you know. Mm-hmm. And then there's a difference where like I'm just chopping people and stuff, and folk are like losing their shit. And I'm like, it's kind of cool.
Yeah,
I'm still not. It wasn't until the Rumble that I was like, okay, this will be fine. You know, like even going into the Rumble, I was still like, Scott, I think they're going to go for Dynamite more than me. And he was like, it'll be fine. But it wasn't until then that I was like, because Rumble was weird. We can get on that in a second.
Well, we will get onto that. But no, yeah, that's the thing. I think since you'd been kind of away and then came back, the foundation had done a good enough job to be despised. Like, there was no redeemable qualities about them that made it all the more better. And it was like Damian was kind of in this weird position where he held the belt, came back, he was still holding the belt, and I seemed to be thinking he was losing the belt whenever he was defending it at that point. So he was kind of in that weird middle ground of, yeah, you're cool.
Did you genuinely think that they were just going to have him non-storyline lose a belt at random shows?
I don't get it
as, not as like a wrestler, but like as a wrestling fan.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if it's Halloween hijinks, right? It's the first show back, there's no build. Mm-hmm. It's just the first show back, and he's against Brad, who, again, there's no build to Brad winning the belt. Why would Damian lose that match?
See, but you say that, I had no reason to think why Chris Archer would beat Allen. I know it's not the top belt, but I had no reason to think that there was no build for that to happen either, and it did. So I was like,
yes,
I suppose.
But the issue is with that,
right?
The build with Damian's belt,
mm-hmm.
there wasn't much, but any of it was directed at Dynamite.
Mm-hmm.
Before lockdown as well, it was all Dynamite. So why would Brad be winning it? I can understand the Christmas one.
Mm-hmm.
I can understand why you might have thought it there, but not the other shows. Come on, Billy.
Well, you know, I've got a track record of being absolutely woeful at predictions for WrestleZone. So
I'm pretty bad as well. I lose any prediction game we do at WrestleMania. I just don't have a clue what I'm doing.
Yeah, I mean, there's a part of Eat Sleep Suplex Retweet, and they do their sweeps every month for shows, and I don't even take part now. It's just embarrassing at this point. I'm just like, I don't know. I just let me watch the show in peace. I don't have to think about who's winning or losing. Just let me enjoy it. I have all that stuff when I'm watching WrestleZone, and I'm wrong. So it's just let me enjoy it. So you're back. Everyone's buzzing. The people are there were several people hitting the ring in excitement and looked excited. I didn't seem to look excited in the footage, but I was just inside. And so we're on the road to the Regal Rumble. Then the Rumble arrived then. So we'll go to the Rumble. And that was possibly one of the most nerve-wracking hours or so of my life at that point, because I was determined you're going to win, of course, because, you know, bias aside. But I thought, Zach might win. So one of you are going to win. I don't know who, though. And I'm obviously best of both worlds. But so you said that Rumble was when you thought, yeah, okay, people really like me.
That was, well, after the Rumble, like when I'd watched it back. Because, see, so going into the Rumble, it was fine. Just as like the countdown's going for my music to play. So we're getting like 10, 9, whatever. I just start seeing stars. And I'm like, so I'm standing at the curtain and I start seeing stars. And I just put my hand on like Tucker's shoulder and I'm like, Tucker, I'm seeing stars. I don't know if this is okay. And he's like, you'll be fine. And I went out, and then whenever you get a chance to see it back, right, I'll do something and then I'll go sit in a corner. And I'll get up to do my next thing and I'll go sit in a corner. Because every time I stood up, I got a head rush. So I was standing up, getting a head rush, doing whatever the thing was, and then going and lying down for a bit till my head rush went away, and then getting up again. And it was like that until the match was over. And then for like an hour, I sat in the hotel room upstairs for like an hour before like I stopped feeling dizzy, and then I left the venue.
So was that just due to, was that a nerves thing or just a...
I don't know. I'm quite chilled out anyway, but like, I don't really get like super hyped about matches or anything, but I don't know if it was just a combination of like, it's actually the first match I've had back, because I didn't have a match at Summerhill. And then I was winning with Dynamite, who'd like been one of my best mates since 11 years ago. Like me and him have been planning this feud for a decade, right? We've been like, you know, just mates hanging out and just talk about, oh, this would be a cool idea if we ever did this or whatever. So like that, and then going out and like, the baby face reaction that I got, and like the crowd were super behind me, and like obviously there was like people chanting my name and stuff. So I was just like, I think it was just a complete adrenaline like overdose sort of thing. And I was just like, fucking, oh fuck, this is weird. And then Tucker pushed me through the curtain. I went through, and then yeah, if you ever watch it back, I'll go in. I'll do like, I don't know, the bit with Dynamite. He goes off, black hole slam, and then I'll just go lie down for a bit while I'm trying not to be spaced out. And then I get back up again, and as soon as I stand up, I get a head rush again, like I stood up too quick off the sofa or something. So that was really weird. And you actually see, after I do the first bit, I come in and I do the bit where Ryan, where he throws me over, and then Kyle pushed me back in. And then I chopped Ronan. And then I went and I did a couple of stomps on someone, and then I sat in the corner, and then I shouted Denzel over. And I was like, Denzel, I can't see properly. And he was like, you just stay there. And then he kept coming and checking on me when I went to sit in corners. So yeah, it was scary. But afterwards, because I was obviously all freaking just dizzy and whatever, I wasn't really sure how it went. And then I watched it back the next day, and then Scott messaged me, and he basically was like, like told you so sort of thing on like how the crowd would take to me, and you know, so I, that was the point where I was like, okay, this will be fine, like this is okay. But that night was equal measures weird and just fucking terrifying at times.
Definitely not from a physical standpoint.
I tombstones dynamite while not being able to see.
Skill. See, man of tremendous talent. Able to do that. I'll get to the Kyle of it all. So he said that it was just you shouted at him and then that was it. He helped.
Yes.
Was there any point afterwards that you were told, don't do that again because it will encourage people to do it? Because it
will. No, I just said to the guys before I went, like in the afternoon, we're planning bits of the match or whatever. And I was like, right, just so you know, when I come in, I'm going to charge Ryan. He's going to sidestep me. I'll be hanging out of the ring like Shawn Michaels style, one foot on the floor, and I'm going to shout at. I assumed that you two would be sitting next to each other. So I was like, I'm going to shout at Billy and Kyle to push me back in the ring. And they were like, what if they don't? And I was like, don't be stupid. don't be so stupid. Of course they will. They never told me not to do it again. They never said not to do it. Their concern was just if what happens if they don't and you look like an idiot because no one saved you. And I was like, well, I'm sure they will.
Sorry, my counterpoint. Well, we arrived late. We didn't. We were in the queue at the right time. Just there was no seats in that particular corner, and I took Jonathan's seat, and he was fucking furious because he came over to sit where we were sitting, and just I could see his face raging. And I did say, Keller's like, what if he asked you? And I would have fucked that up. I could have guaranteed you that I would have went like pulled your leg the other way, and absolutely ruined it. And it would have spoilt the whole thing. So I was glad that I wasn't really given any responsibility for it.
But. No, I just said, like, I'm gonna shout at them to get me back in the ring because that's a pop. And they're like, well, what if they don't? I was like, just don't be so stupid. Come on.
Yeah, so that happened. And then that was my first heart attack of that match because the things I shouted at Dennis throughout that match was obscene at times. Kelly did look at me thinking, I don't know what I've married because I've never seen this person before, as I was just belting things at folk. But no, I appreciated the road dog method of do something and then go back into the corner and just...
I mean, that wasn't intentional. Like, I wouldn't have been doing that if I could see. But I was... I had stars and I was, like, seeing spots. And every time I stood up, it's like, I need to go sit down again.
So you had that. We got towards the right. The whole finish, the original finish, that before the match got restarted. I had a bone to pick with Zach and Dennis about this, but this is a whole other thing. So was that another point where you said afterwards you realized everyone got it? But was that the moment where when you were thrown out and everyone reacted? Did that also
when I threw dynamite out and there was the initial like pop for me.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, okay, I get this. This is working. And then obviously when the crowd were giving him shit because he just cheated me, I was like, okay. So they hate him and they like me. That's fine. This will be fine. Yeah, that was probably. And then when Len restarted it, I added in a little bit there with Len just for like, you know, smart march, you know what I mean?
Oh yeah, nerds.
Right in front of you, you know?
Of course.
Like, so obviously, me and Len had feuded for ages and never been on good terms, so that's why I was like, Len, we're going to shake hands before I go back in the ring. I was like, okay, if you want. So that's all that was. That was just me being like, Len's restarted it. Because there was a bit, obviously, when I'm going to leave, because I've lost, and he's like, no, not this way. It's like we're just gonna have that like John Moxley William Regal thing, you know, where like they feuded for ages but there's like a respect even if they don't like each other. That's what I wanted it to be. So me and Len did the wee handshake, And if you, again, if you watch the footage back, we're standing over beside like the stage, and as like, who was ring announcing? Mikey.
Yeah, Mikey. Yeah.
So as he's like explaining the match is getting restarted, I go, Len, go over there, and I push him over in front of you, and then I walk over and I go like that.
I appreciate it. I like
that. That was for me and for like three people in the crowd, but I liked it.
And then, of course, the match restarted, and then I had my possibly fifth heart attack that night when you were on the apron, and then you did the slip again. Because I think I had an out-of-body experience at that point when you did it. Because I saw Kyle look at me as well when it happened.
Yeah, they all, I've watched it back, and they all look at you. Everyone looks at you.
I wasn't ready. I was like, oh, God, I was sweating.
Well, that was another bit when I was like, right. As I'm walking up here to get you dynamite, I'm just going to slip off the apron. And he was like, what? And I was like, I just need to do it. So I had to get it.
It was
like, I need to get every moment where it looks like I'm fucked. You know? Yeah. So, well, it's the thing as well. So, like, I like doing, like, callbacks and stuff to shit. Mm-hmm. So, first Rumble I was in, I was in for a little bit and then Crusher destroyed me. So there was a bit in this Rumble where I'd been in for a little bit and then like I turn up around and Crusher's there and I'm like, oh crap, and then he gets on me. The second Rumble I was in, I slid in, charged Scott and he threw me straight out. So that was the Ryan bit. And then the next one, well, the next one I got jumped by Jay Lethal and Sonjay Dutt and Grado for some reason and got whatever. The one after that was the one where I slipped out. So I got the slip in. I just recreated all my Rumble eliminations until I won.
With the one that you got jumped, that was Len was in it. And you jumped Len before he entered. Wasn't it? So I suppose...
No. That was the year after.
Right,
because I'd already been eliminated and Len came back out and I beat him up and took his belt. That year, Len had came out to do like a promo. I don't know what the promo was for. I came out and I challenged him to a match at Anarchy and then knocked him out.
Right.
But yeah, I got basically all my Rumble eliminations. I just recreated every one of them in that Rumble until I won at the end. Don't know what I'm going to do next year's Rumble.
You have to win it outright, I suppose. That's kind of the only way you can top it.
Yeah.
I mean, you'd have to be, unless you're the champion at that point.
Landing at the same time was fucking stressful. I did speak to Zach about it.
I spoke to Zach and he pretty much just went, no, it was luck. He kind of had to guess because he was shorter. So he had
that
to.
Wasn't the, did he tell you that that wasn't the original finish?
He didn't, no. But he might have, but his internet kept cutting out.
It was the original finish, but they wanted us to both land at the same time twice. And me and Dynamite were like, guys, maybe once. I don't know how we're going to time it. Because I'm like a foot taller than him. And I would have to jump. He'd have to go, or he'd have to go slightly before me. Because he's shorter, but then I'm also heavier, so maybe I would go down faster. And I was like, oh, it's stressful. So if we'd have had to do that twice, like do it once, then restart it, and then do it again, but that was pure luck. There was no, because we ended up just being like, we're just gonna have to fucking just do it and hope for the best. And it was pretty spot on, to be fair. Like I do think. I might have landed slightly before him.
I think he did as well because there was a child behind Dennis that pointed at you saying that he landed first.
And yeah, you would have to really like slow the footage down to see it, but I think I might have landed slightly before him. But because we were on opposite sides of the ring and it was just a little bit, I think it worked out fine.
Oh yeah, it didn't. Yeah, that whole night was just incredible. Just, I mean, the whole show was really great. And it was weird because obviously full partaking it because of COVID. Scotty was out because of COVID and all that kind of stuff. So yeah. It was just a strange night overall. That, and I was like, yeah. And well, you were obviously seeing stars and blind at the end of during and at the end of it as well. Yeah. And we were properly on the road. I'm actually getting goosebumps just thinking about it again because it was such a weird night. I get emotional at shows anyway. My face doesn't usually show up. This is one of the few times that I was like properly outwardly shouting and just going wild at a show. And yeah. It was.
Well, you're like opposite hard cam on the footage as well.
Oh great.
Or you know, is it hard cam? You know, no. The hard cam must have been on the stage. I think hard cam's on the stage, but the ringside camera was like just on this side of the ring, the opposite side from the hard cam. So you're on camera the whole time, like leaning over people going like this and stuff.
Try not to swear. That's kind of my whole game of it.
The best thing is when I slip though, and then you just like slowly like sink into your body. There.
Yeah. yeah, that was I'm over it, but then when we speak about it again, it's like I'm still not kind of over it. I'm gonna have to get a hold of the old DVD and watch it back just to closure on it.
I'll send you that clip just so you can see everyone on this side of the ring slowly turn their head towards you, and then you just like shrivel up, you know, like someone's poured like salt onto a slug. You just like, shh. Yeah.
It was emotional. It was an emotional night.
I don't even know if you saw me look at you after I slipped either, because you were already like.
I don't think I slipped,
and then I looked over at you and I went, that was close.
No, I didn't see that. Kyle did tell me that you looked over at me, but at that point I was probably head in hands, just praying. And I was like, I don't know why. Like, I don't know why I find it so. It's wrestling, though. Everyone does, but they're not even the voice. No voice in the back of my head going, you know, it's not real. Like my dad's voice.
No, but that's the whole point, isn't it? You want to get invested in it.
Oh yeah,
I do. I like. I've been doing this 11 years. I think I know what's real and what's not. But I still like. You know, I still watch stuff, and I'm like, oh shit, fuck.
Still get to enjoy it. That's a nice way. Anyway, right. Question, Ronan King, how privileged were you to get, hang on, how privileged were you, spell that wrong, how privileged were you to get to touch Ronan King's chest?
That was a good job. I'll say that. That was a good job I gave him there. He'd been giving me shit on Twitter for about 2 weeks. So. I think that was 2 weeks of worth of a job.
Possibly, yeah, that seemed fair. What are you thinking of these newer guys that are coming? So of course, when you came back, Evan and Ronan are now on shows, and guys like Connor's now properly doing well as well. So when you see all these younger lads come through,
I don't think Connor was on shows when I left.
Was the Anarchy of the Beach Leisure Centre? Was that your last show before you came back?
Age match, yeah.
So yeah, he had a match at a Proving Grounds, I think, and then he interfered in Crusher's match that night.
Yeah, and so I wouldn't have seen anything there. To be honest, I've not seen a lot of stuff other than the stuff that like the shows have been on, if I've been able to like get a wee watch or whatever, or like if I've done a seminar. But the seminars that I did was like, it was still when there were restrictions and stuff, so there was no contact or anything. But like the bits that I've seen, I think Ronan's really good. Connor's really good as well. I don't know how. Well, I've obviously it's just a way to start being singles, I guess, since Crusher's gone. But so that'll be interesting. Evan Young. The only match I've seen of his was his match at Anarchy. I think there's a lot of potential there. But I think for me, like out of the ones that out of like the group of them that I've seen, like Ronan to me has got like the biggest upside anyway. He's what I think is like he's got the like the confidence that I had when I was just starting as well. He's in much better shape than I was. He's in much better shape than I am now. But yeah, like, I don't know, there's something about obviously I came straight in as a heel. Whereas like a lot of these guys are coming in as baby faces, and then, you know, they'll be in with like the more experienced heels, and the heel will be helping them through the match and stuff. Whereas Ronan's going in as a heel, which is a much more difficult thing when you're starting, but he's doing really well with it. So I think, from what I've seen anyway, I think he's probably got the biggest sort of upside to him anyway.
Yeah, he's certainly...
Omar's all right as well, I guess.
I love Omar. I
think he's all right. He's okay.
He does have a question, which is great. Segues all over the place. But yeah, so Ronan, yeah, he's using social media well as well, which is something that's probably really important nowadays.
Yeah.
I mean, as well as the wrestling itself. But yeah, he's fully committed to the Ronan King-ness of it all. And
yeah,
he's certainly... Because that was one thing. Obviously, I was excited for the Rumble anyway. It's a Rumble. And of course, I was thinking you were going to win. But the fact that he was goading you, I was like, oh, this will be fun when it happens, when you get in the ring. And that's like in our moment that was built up, like just on a side quest of Ronan getting smacked the fuck at some point.
The thing, like I turned up and I was like, I turned up and he's there. And I was like, look, give me shit online. When I come in, once I've done my thing with Ryan, just start giving me shit. I'm going to give you one chop, bump it, and then roll away. And it's one of those things where I would have been the same, like, at the time, where it's like, all I did was go in, give him one chop, and his, like, chest was bleeding, and then afterwards he was like, thank you so much, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, you're thanking me for just destroying your chest, but you're welcome.
You want another? Yeah.
Yeah.
So speaking of Omar, back on the moments, he's put favourite Omar Muhammad moment.
Omar. I don't know where I'm going to get Omar. I'm going to video call Omar right now.
I think you might set the record for most appearances on the podcast if he answers.
It says he was active 20 minutes ago. Come on, Omar.
We'll let it side down.
That's just, fuck's sake, what a scumbag.
Omar, worst person.
So, what was his other question? Because he asked two.
Oh, I put, what is merch?
Okay. Right. So, Omar... Omar is one of those guys that's he's constantly trying to like get feedback and he wants to learn and whatever. So he messaged me quite a lot. We were talking for a while about merch, what kind of merch he should get. I'm trying to get him to get. So he comes out with shades. I'm trying to get him to get shades with like Omar Muhammad on the side or Sensation or something. But we're talking about merch, whatever. And then the next day, says he's active now. The next day, I got a message through and he's printed off like 8x10s of himself. Like the photos, like the sexy pictures of him when he's like looking off to the side and stuff. That was me, I took them. So he's printed them off and he sent me a photo of them and he went, would this be classed as merch? And I was like, what? What do you mean? Are you selling them? And he's like, yeah. It's like, well, yeah. I don't know what you're saying to me. And he just seemed very confused. And I don't know why. I'm calling him again because it says he's online. But yeah, he asked me if 8x10s were classed as merch.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hello. You're on the
Billy Strachan podcast.
Again.
Was just telling, oh, look, he's at the unit. He's at training.
I'm at the unit.
He's at training. Yeah.
I'm at training.
So, I've just been informing Billy about your concerns over where, whether 8x10s were classed as merch or not. So, yeah, do you want to explain yourself to Billy? I don't know if he can hear you very well.
I can hear you. I can hear you fine.
So, if you want to explain yourself,
I'll shut the door. I regret now. I thought that because 8x10s were just sort of pictures, they didn't really count as merch. I thought the t-shirts and everything was merch.
And I had to let him know that if you're selling something with your face on it or your name on it, that would be merchandise, yes.
And he had lots of merchandise at Anarchy.
I know.
Plenty.
I know. So, yeah. That was that was what I just thought I would let you explain yourself there.
What a fun conversation that was.
I'll let you get back to training then.
We're taking through some drills. They're death. They're just death.
Oh, so I've just saved you from some drills.
No, we're doing the one that Dynamite did at FCW.
Oh, okay. So yeah, everyone's gonna die. Okay, I will let you die then. Goodbye.
Okay.
So there's Omar.
There we go. Bonus Omar. That's weird. Now Omar's appeared in an episode of his own, two episodes of his own. He's cameoed in in one for FPWA. He's cameoed in this one, and he cameoed in the Abby Arnicky road trip one I did as well by taking my phone. So he's all over the place.
King of the podcast.
Yes, the MVP of the podcast. So that's that out the way. We'll get on to Anarchy itself then. So of course you after the Rumble's finished, you're just about alive. You can see again.
Yep.
And you've watched the back and you think, right, everyone's all in on this. We've got the mega good guy in yourself. We've got the mega bad guy in Zach. We've got Damien the champion, who's kind of floating, just floating in between, being good and bad. He said the finish was, the chair shots was the worst thing. But in general, how did you find going into the match? And were you able to see for one?
That was fine.
Yeah,
that was fine. That venue's hot as it is, but like it was hot that night. I don't know why. It must have just been like quite a mild night or something, but then the hotel was fully booked out, so every room was taken, so I feel like there might have been folk underneath in rooms with like heating on, that the heating was coming up, because the heating wasn't on in the room in the venue, but it was ridiculously hot.
Oh yeah.
I think I was in the match like 2 minutes and my hair was dry. My hair was soaking wet when I went out. It was dry within like 2-3 minutes. That was horrible. Which I was kind of glad that I just got to lie on my belly for like the last 2.5-3 minutes of that match while they did their cool little moves and stuff, and I just lay there. I could honestly have fallen asleep right there and then, because I was just gone. But like the match was fine. I didn't do like a tremendous amount, but it wasn't about me. It was about Dynamite winning the belt and about Damien losing the belt. So it was their match. I was just a bit of dressing. I was mayonnaise on the side or something.
There was one bit though that, like, again, heart and mouth kind of scare was when the turnbuckle got exposed and you got whipped onto it, you got pulled off the second rope and then landed on it, and then there was a little bit of a silence. How was that?
Fine. I've taken that bump like double digits amount of times. It was fine. It's just, it looks fucking horrible. So it's a good moment of like put the good guy in peril because he's just absolutely died. My heart and mouth moment was when Dynamite almost fell out of the ring when I was giving him a gorilla press.
Oh yeah.
And I had to like fully like Cesaro him up. That was I think he just had way too much energy and he just went. But I managed to like get him there. And so that was my heart in the mouth moment, because I was like, oh shit, I'm about to drop him out of the onto the floor and I'm just gonna have to win the belt.
Oh no. That would be terrible. But I think when I was speaking to Zach, obviously this episode will be out. That episode will be out before this one is, obviously. But yeah, he was saying that the only bit that he was like, oh shit, about was I think he had a drop kick on him quite early on, and he just wasn't, I don't know if he wasn't ready for it, but
the one to the outside.
Yeah, you got him flush really, really hard with it.
Yeah, and he flew up the aisle and like almost took out some kids and stuff as well. Sorry.
So I did ask him if that was the reason why he put a little bit extra welly into the chair shots, but no, it just sounds like it's just terrible with chairs then.
It was I enjoyed the match. It was intense. Like me and Dynamite are always quite. Sorry, I don't know why. I think my hay fever my eye keeps tripping. Dynamite and me always like we're quite. Hit each other quite hard and it gets quite intense. So if it ends up being me and him at Halloween, that could be quite a it could be quite a strong style match. But no, I enjoyed it. As I say, it wasn't about me. It was about them too. So I was just happy to be like, you guys do what you want. It's about him winning the belt. How do you want to win this belt? And I'm just here to add in bits.
Yeah, and just to die in the corner. Again, I've said it enough in other podcasts that I really love that match. I think it was Scotty I was speaking to about the match itself, and I was saying it's probably one of my favorites, if not maybe top three ever in WrestleZone I've seen.
Yeah. Scotty messaged us the next day. No, it wasn't even that. It wasn't that. It was when he came, we got back to the crowd. I'm thinking of Rumble, because Rumble, he wasn't there, obviously, so he watched it back. But once we got back through the curtain, Scott was like, the first thing he said to me, he was like, best match ever happened in this venue. And I was like, okay. Because I'd at that point been lying in the ring for almost 15 minutes because folk were not leaving the fucking room.
Yeah, there's what I mean. Some people left as soon as Dynamite won because they were disgusted.
There's a cracking video of a kid getting up and like angrily like squeezing the back of a chair and then giving Dynamite two fingers.
Perfect.
But I'm lying in the ring and like Martin's telling people to leave because they need to check on me or whatever, mm-hmm. and people are just sitting like this. Like nothing else is happening. The show's over. Like William Sterling's out taking the ring down while I'm still lying in it because we need to go. Please leave. And I'm just lying there. Tell me when they're gone so I can leave. Nope, they're still here. And then I'm being like checked on or whatever. And then someone came up and put a fucking Red Bull in my hand while I'm dead and unconscious. See if I was actually hurt. See if this was like a crusher at the ballroom, mm-hmm. and I was lying in the ring waiting for like a paramedic to come, and some fan just walked up and put a Red Bull in my hand while I'm dying. What were they thinking? I don't get people.
Fine, they're all horrible. I that was probably one of the few I didn't hang about for ages, because I wanted to go home and see Eurovision. I'm not gonna lie. I didn't really see the show, and then I thought, right, this must be the natural end. I need to go home and see Eurovision.
Rasmus.
I know, and I mean, I got in literally for the last three public votes, so I missed all of it. Anyway, I came in just in time to see us lose. So it was a good night all around for me there. That was. Shouting at every arsehole on the road that was slowing me down, going, I want to get in, I don't want to go home. Eat my pizza while it's still hot. So yeah, so that's pretty much the end of the wrestling, your wrestling up until that point. We really kind of skipped over quite a few things, like but we'll go back to your no count out, no time limit match in disco with Brad, that when I was getting the results seemed to span the whole night.
It was two segments. So it was originally, I don't know if, is this going to ever happen? Fuck it. It was originally meant to be me and Doug Williams.
Right.
Because it was meant to be like the raffle gimmick. So, you know, it's random person, third one's the stipulation or whatever. So it was going to be me and Doug Williams in like a submission match or something. It's like a like a rematch from last time we did it at Discovery. Because it's been like 5 years or something since then, which is mental. But so he got hurt like a week before the show or something. And they're like, we don't know who to put you in against. Like, just give us a list of people and we'll pick someone. We'll get someone for you. And I just went, I've got the message somewhere. I just went, give me Bruiser Brad. And that was it. So they gave me Bruiser Brad. And then we turned up and we don't have a stipulation because every match has to have a stipulation. So we're trying to figure it out. And they're like, oh, you could do, let's do no count out. Like, because they didn't want to do like a hardcore match or something, which I was trying. I tried to get a dog collar match, and because Brad's got his chain, and there's an Asda around the corner from the venue, could have got some dog collars. But they were like, right, we'll do no count out. Okay. But then I was like, it's not going to be anything special if we just have a match with no count out, because if we just, we can brawl a bit, but it's not making it any different than most like other matches nowadays. So that's why I was just like, right, what if, how long have we got for this match? And like 15. What if we go 10, then we just go backstage and then you do two more matches and then we come out and do 5. Okay, so that's what we did. It was all right. It was actually, see if I can do every match like that. That'd be the best. You do like 10 minutes, go backstage, get your breath back, have a drink of water, go over the rest of the match so you don't forget it, and then go back out and finish the match. Brilliant. Easiest match ever.
So you said drink of water. Remember rightly when we last spoke that you're kind of weaning yourself off the monster, or am I misremembering?
I was cutting down on it because I was drinking a lot. Mm-hmm. I've got a monster right here, so.
Right. Fair.
I'm trying to just have one a day compared to like 3 or 4, 6. So I'm trying to have one. That's the only one I've had today.
Okay. I was during the road trip episode. I was in Aston and got the gold one. The pineapple, really nice. And yeah, I made a joke in the video saying that it was for you because you were going to win the title tonight and all that kind of stuff. But I was like, this is a bloody good purchase in the meal deal. It was lovely.
Yeah.
Speaking of that, Westy's got a question.
Okay.
How many cans of Monster do you usually can to get through a double duty of wrestling events?
So, double duty, as in like if I've got two matches in one night. Or as in like two shows in a weekend? What's that?
You're not often do two shows a day, but just, yeah, I would say two a week. If you've got a run of shows that weekend, I suppose, we'll go with that.
Not much, to be honest. What I'll probably do is, so I've got a show tomorrow. So I'll probably have one on the way to the show. Put another one in my case, and then about 10 minutes before my match I'll drink half the can, and then I'll down the rest of it just before I go through the curtain, and then that'll be me. Unless it's one of those days where I go out and I have a match and then a fan's brought me an energy drink, because that happens more than it should. And then I'll have another one after my match. But normally I just drink it before I go out. So that, I don't know, it's stupid, because I'm probably getting more blown up because of it, because I've got all the carbonation in me and stuff. But I don't know. That's just what I do.
I'm still trying to stay off it, because, yeah, I don't know what it is now. If I have one, my heart starts to...
Thinking now, I think... At the Anarchy match, like, just before we went out, so I had a Monster. I think Dynamite had a Monster as well. He'd had like 2-3 coffees. But before we went out, we both had a shot, like a little pre-workout shot before we went to the ring. So that's probably why we were both like launching each other about and shit. Yeah, that's probably why. I've just thought about that.
But no, I'm quite liking the Lucozade do one now. Lucozade energy, like just a can. It's really nice. And Boost Juice as well.
Heathen. No.
I just find, I like it. It's still carbonated. Only, it doesn't make me want to die.
The only ones I drink are the Monster Zeros. Mm-hmm. Everything else seems to give me like bad heartburn now. Mm-hmm. So I just have Monster Zero, either the white or the red or the black or the lime green one. Sometimes for a treat, I'll have a full fat Red Bull. Just for a treat.
I like the, well, the sugar, this is such a this is super tangent of proportions, but if I get the Tesco meal deal, I always get the big sugar-free Red Bull, because, you know...
I can't have a sugar-free Red Bull.
See, that's part horrible. Of me, I like it, but at the same time, I only have it because it's, the meal deal's £3 and that sugar-free Iron Brew is £1.99. I'm like, I'm gonna make the most of my £3 here and just get as much as I can
for
that amount.
I don't like the sugar-free Red Bull. I like the zero-calorie Red Bull.
All right, it's the darker blue, isn't it?
The grey is no. The dark blue is just the full fat one.
Mm-hmm.
Don't know why we say full fat, because it's not fat; it's sugar, it's carbs. Anyway, full fat Red Bull. Then the light blue one is the sugar-free, and then the zero-calorie one is the same design as the other two, but it's like, instead of blue, it's like a charcoal grey.
Right, okay.
That was nice.
I thought it was like a really dark blue, and I might be slightly...
No, it's a charcoal. It's like a charcoal grey. I'm very particular about colours, because I'm colourblind, and I worked in a formal wear shop, so I know all the little... French navy. That's a good colour.
I like it. Is there a particular brand of pink that you use then for most of your gear, when you do have the pink? Is there a name for it?
The one that I've got for my new gear is way, way too bright. I normally get, I'll ask for more like a fuchsia or like a hot pink. But this one was like, it's like if you went to a rave and you're wearing neon fucking pink. And because I'm colorblind, so I had all these lists of the different materials and stuff. And I was like, I don't know which one, because a lot of them look the same. Mm-hmm. But they didn't have in stock the one that I would normally get. So I'm like, I don't know which one to get. So I sent them to Debbie and went, which pink looks better? And she went, that one. And I got it. And it's fucking neon pink. And it's very bright. I've not tested it for glow-in-the-dark yet, but if it does glow-in-the-dark, that could be cool.
That last time she was trusted to pick anything.
Pretty much. Because it didn't match my knee pads or my socks. Every pink I had on that day was a different pink. Kind of disappointed in myself.
So last thing on the Anarchy match, and then we can move on to other things, because we do have stuff about posters, which kind of will tail into the colour stuff. We've got Callum Bruce coming in with... I think he kind of answered this already. He's put Damien or Zach, who do you want, or do we run the three-way back? I think, who would you rather face, or would you want to do a triple threat again?
I fucking hate triple threats with a passion. I think I've only had a singles match with Damien once. That was in Montrose, I think. Was it? I think it was Montrose. It was the main event. He was the champion, I'm sure.
I'll see if the old cage match has it to help.
Or was I Tri-County's champion? No, he was the champion.
It was, well, I've got Tariff as one. Special guest, just 2018.
Rich Russell, I forgot about that match.
Yeah, I've got that one.
That was the match where I walked to the ring and then got in the ring and then looked down and realised I hadn't changed my shorts and I was just wearing a pair of like Gold's Gym short shorts. And I was like, well, this is a...
And you're right, Montrose. Tri-County Championship.
Tri-County's, okay. So, they were all right. I think... I don't know. I quite like Dynamite to keep the belt so that I can win the belt off him. But I don't mind whoever it is.
I suppose for your own possible safety, because as you're saying, you and Zach were just absolutely wheel on each other.
Yeah.
Possibly just for you to survive, not survive.
And if it's the Halloween show as well, if it ends up being Dynamite, I'm going to try and wangle my way into a Halloween brawl. So that could get very... We'll see. It probably won't happen. I'll probably not get my way, but I'll try.
When it comes to the Halloween brawl, then, is there any... Have you already got in mind... I mean, you've done death matches, but have you already got in mind, like, Halloween-centric weapons you'd bring to the table?
I think because it would be for the title, it'd be the main event, I think it would have to be a more serious Halloween brawl.
Right.
So rather than it being, like, Halloween ornaments or weapons and stuff, I think it would have to be, like, I don't know, like a couple of chairs spray-painted orange and black, and then, you know, like, just more of a Halloween theme still, because it's a Halloween show, but more of a serious sort of weapons match, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And Calm's other question was, it was just, can we get more XXL merch? Some of us are big boys. We're all big boys. We're all big boys here.
In the XXL. Country. I don't think I've ever had XXL. I've had, no, 2XL I've had. Did he say 3Xs or 2?
No, 2Xs. Okay. XX. Yeah.
So, the reason I don't normally get loads of 2XL is because fucking 2 years later, I'll still be left with giant t-shirts that nobody buys. So I get large XL the most, and then it'll be medium, and then small and 2XL. I normally get the same amount. I mean, I can try.
It's weird though, because I've still got your first skull tee.
That's the best one. That one still fits me today, and I don't know how.
That's it. I was about to say that as well. I think it was a large I bought at the time, and I am not a large anymore.
My one. So, if I was getting a t-shirt now, I would either get a large or an XL. That's a medium, and it still fits me. I don't know why. It's a Gildan soft style.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it might be. I think it might be that. Because, like, the other ones that I've had, the Lost Boy one with, like, the feathers and the skull with the hat and the feathers and all that, that's Gildan soft style as well, and that one still fits me well. The other ones are getting quite small, but I don't know what it is. That must just, like, continue to stretch with you as you grow, because the material...
But no, that one still fits me fine. And when I know it's your style, usually I'll just go XL because I'm like, generally they fit me for some reason. But I got an XL Foundation Future one, and it is figure hugging. I'll say that.
I've got a lot. My Foundation one is here somewhere, and it's a large, and it's I've got to do like you know the fat guy stretch.
I know it well. Yeah.
I don't know why. But I do try whenever I get merch to make sure it's a Gildan soft style if they do it. because they always seem to fit really well. Because that's what I never understood. The first ones I got, that like the original one that you're talking about there, I gave one of them to Jay Lethal. When I got them made, I was a fucking wee skinny boy, right? And Jay Lethal's Jay Lethal. I was like, what size do you need? And he was like, medium. And I was like, I'm a medium. We're both wearing mediums and it fits them fine. And I'm like, I don't understand these t-shirts. They're mental.
But those t-shirts are always kind of a hot topic. Because when I've been to shows since I saw one with Hurricane, and he was really interested in the skull design. And then I think Kyle said that he saw Eric Rowan, and he was really interested in the whole skull design as well. It just seems they're just cool t-shirts, and that, of course, the first.
That's what I like. I don't want my t-shirts to be like blatantly wrestling ones. Like the most wrestling t-shirt I've ever had is the newest one that I've got because it's got me on it.
Yeah, yeah.
To be honest, I don't like it. I designed it, and then once I got them printed out, I got one for myself or whatever, and I was wearing it, and I was like, I don't like this. I don't like this t-shirt. So the next one I do, because the thing I did with the t-shirts as well, it was always, it's very like, oh, it's another skull. But if you look at them, the skull evolves and changes, like, depending on when I got it done and like within like my time in wrestling. So yeah, the first one's just obviously me with a skull. The second one was
the Rust Devil one.
Yeah, there was the playing card one in between that, but right. I don't count that because I like it. It's a fine t-shirt. I just don't count it as like I've got like a set. It's almost like a series of t-shirts, mm-hmm. and it's all just this skull facing forward. That looks like me. So like the Rust Devil one was that one. It came out, I got it, it arrived too late. I was originally meant to have them for when I did the first death match that I did, which is why it's a lot more like beaten up and it's got teeth missing and stuff, and then it's got the little Filthy Gen logo in the eye. And then I think then it was the Lost Boy one. Is it just three of them?
If you don't count the King of Catch card one, yeah. Then yeah, that'll be
so it. Then that was more of the when I started going by Lost Boy, and it's got the snapback that I used to wear and stuff. So I do need to get an updated one but it's like I like that as it's not so much just like a t-shirt, it's like a series of like art pieces almost. Mm-hmm. But I need to make another one because I don't like the t-shirt that I've got just now.
I think the only one I haven't got, well, two I haven't got of yours, I think, will be Rust Devil. I don't have that one. And
they are online. They're online.
They're on T-Mail, aren't they? So
yeah.
Eventually I'll remember at the start of, because it's start of the month to do free post. So I'm like, I'll wait to start of the month.
I have some things coming out on T-Mail, which I can't talk about just now. But it's good shit and you'll like it. I'll tell you after the recording.
Okay.
If you remind me.
I'll write it down. I'll just put shirt and hope that I remember from that point. Cool. That's fine. Right. Speaking of Chatspad afterwards, like I got the PG version as much as you could of the Marty Jones story, and then of course we went to Vegas and told the rest of it. That was incredible.
I still don't think I've told the whole story. At any point, because there's parts of it that like killed my inner child a bit, and because I used to watch him on the wrestling channel when I was over at my grand's house, and you know, and then he was a dick, so it kind of there's bits of that day that I haven't like said on any podcast. I probably won't, to be honest.
That's absolutely fine, but no, that's that whole story. I think like I've done so many episodes by that point, and I don't know what your episode was about, but like it seemed to be that was one where I had the more wilder stories come out, and then from that point, all the podcasts seemed to just be somehow getting some weird stories out of people on the shows. But no, the cheese sandwich still makes me laugh, and it will always make me laugh. If anyone, if I see a cheese sandwich, it'll still just give me a,
yeah, I still a wee chuckle. I still don't really know what he meant by that. I'm assuming he meant catering in general, you know, backstage at shows, but the wording of it just makes it sound like cheese sandwiches were invented after his, while he was already an adult.
And that's what I'll choose to believe. That's just, I don't want to think of it any other way. Right. So we're speaking about colors, we've been colorblind and whatnot. And we're not, yeah, this is not the story, but this is the question, but kind of, I'm intrigued with it. So I've got Kev asking, favorite and or least favorite poster you've ever designed?
I don't know, like, if I've got any specific favorite ones. Like, if you go on to my, like, link tree and, like, my bios and stuff, there's, like, my portfolio on there. So there's a bunch of posters on there that I'm somewhat happy with, so that I've obviously used them as, like, my folio to try and get work. So those are, anything that's on there is I'm probably, like, pretty happy with, but I don't know, like, because I don't like anything I do, and I don't like any of my matches, and so it's a difficult one, but I like, more so than anything, there's certain promotions that I like doing stuff for, because they're happy for me to just do whatever I want. So, like, Discovery just lets me do whatever the fuck I want, and that's why, like, a lot of their posters are cool. WrestleZone pretty much lets me do whatever. The ones I've done for TNT I quite like. They're more specific on what they want, like, but Keith Ness, what are they called?
Combat League.
They give me a show name, and they're just like, do what you want, make it colorful. So, like, those are the kind of ones I like, because it's just, let me do what you want, mm-hmm, and I'll give you something cool. I think they turn out, Discovery ones and Combat League and WrestleZone, I think, tend to turn out better, because I'm just allowed to be creative with it and just do it. Whereas I think sometimes I'll make a poster for somewhere, and then they'll come back with changes they want, and then I'm not happy with the poster afterwards, because it's not like the vision that I had for the poster. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, I mean, so speaking of that, then, of course, you're saying that you struggle with colors and what have you. So, like, with those ones, you're given free reign, so you kind of, you know what will go together, what shades will go together. But when, yeah, you do have someone come back to you going, no, it has to be this color, has to be that, is that when it becomes a bit more work at that point?
Yeah, like, I mean, there's a lot of, I have, like, regular work for places, but there's a lot of times where it's just, like, a promotion will come at me and be like, we need a poster for this event, like, can you do one, whatever, and it's just, like, a one-off, or sometimes it leads to more, or whatever, and they tend to be, like, they'll have either had someone doing posters for them before, so they've got an idea in their head what they want the poster laid out and stuff, and I'll kind of be like, that's not really, like, my style or whatever. Like, if you just tell me what information you want, who you want on it, I'll get you something cool. But it's when the colors aren't too much of an issue, because, like, I'm 32, I've been using Photoshop since I was 14. Like, I figured out where the colors are on the wheel, you know what I mean? But it's like, if I've got all the information, like the date and the venue and tickets and who they want on it and stuff, I could sit here and do a poster in like an hour and be done. The last poster I did, well, not the last poster, but like in that sort of way where it's just like a random place messages you, it was the Kamikaze Pro. I did their latest poster, and the poster took me like 40 minutes to do. but then I'll have somewhere else, say TNT, for example, and I'll do a poster, and then they want changes, and they'll change it, and then they want something else changed. So it becomes like a process, and that's when I start to like zone out. And I'll just be like, okay, I have to kind of just get in my head, like, this isn't for me, this is what they want, so you know what I mean? I do what they want, that's, and they'll be happy. Yeah. But I might not like it in the end. Whereas the ones that I do like are the ones that it's all me. Just do what you want. Like the newest Discovery ones I really like, the pink with the disco ball and stuff on it. Mm-hmm. It's got like the little pattern in the background, like from the old bus seats back in the day. But like that was just me. It's Disco Derby, do what you want. Okay. And that's a very me poster.
Yeah, I mean, you definitely got a style, and especially with all the pink and black as well. It's like, well, you can kind of tell now what you're, if it's you, it's done it kind of thing. You're, yeah, you're kind of style things. But do you ever go look at?
Like, I think everyone's got their own style. You can tell, like, I can tell who's done what poster. Certain people put their logos on posters and stuff, like, you know, their design logo. I don't know if I might start doing that just so that people see it and go, oh, maybe we could use him, sort of thing. Because there's not really any association other than everyone has their own style, you know what I mean? Like, I can tell who does a poster just by looking at it. And I think that's good that you can kind of, that way promotions can be like, if I want my posters to look like this, I need to go to this person. And, you know what I mean? So,
is there ever time, I mean, so you're in this fine line between perfectionist and pessimist. I feel it's like everything could be better, but everything's bad at the same time. But when you see other people's posters, do you have a little, if you see a wrestling poster and you look at it and go, why have they put that out? What have they done?
All the time, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, all the time. I'm like, that's shite. I've done a couple of times, I've seen a poster and went, can't be having this, and messaged the promotion and was like, look, I do posters, would you like me to make your posters look better? And it's got me some work from it, but I put my foot in it one time, I didn't mean to. I messaged a promoter being like, I don't like this poster, I can't share this, I know I'm on the show, but I can't share this poster. And then they were like, I made the poster. I was like, oh fuck.
Well, get good.
Like, oh shit, I'm sorry.
Yeah. But no, I did my time. I made the ones for like, there was a period of maybe a couple of shows for Rock and Wrestle, and I was tasked with making them. Fuck that. No, I'm quite happy just to leave it to people that know what they're doing. I was just so confused.
I mean, I don't know if I know what I'm doing. I just taught myself. I just don't understand people putting out posters that look like shit. So just either work on it and get your posters look better, because surely people don't look at something and think it's good. I don't know, maybe I'm just, I don't know, man.
If you're going to be professional, you got to present yourself as such, kind of thing. It's when I see some, I won't name them because that's pointless at this stage, but if you see some match cards or like match graphics, I'm looking at them going, I know A, nothing about this show, B, I don't know who that is, C, I was looking at it going, this is fucking pointless, why have you made this, this is telling me nothing.
The worst ones are the ones that are like American wrestling across the top.
Oh god,
I hate that so much. If I ever got asked to do a poster with American wrestling across the top of it, I would say, give someone else this job, please. No, I can't do this.
When you're saying that, I don't know if it's just coincidence, but you did some for Wrestling Showdown, didn't you, for W3L, and they used to have their posters say American wrestling, and then suddenly they stopped having it. Which
I only did two posters for them. One was... It was like a... One like Seven Deadly Sins tournament poster with had Joe Legend on the front of it with like Kevin Williams and Luke Aldridge and stuff. And then the other one I did was like a generic tour poster with all the dates.
I think it was the Northern tour, wasn't it?
Yeah, the one where I instigated Bulgarian Baker into orbit.
It's a sad thing. Sad thing. Yeah. That was a show where you shouted at me to buy a t-shirt when I was wearing one of your t-shirts.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was...
That was also the one that I kept. I was in a tag match with Musso. He was on my team. And I kept calling him Michael, and he was getting really annoyed. But that's the only two posters I've ever done for them. I offer every now and then to do their posters again, but they've obviously got something that they're happy with. So. Mm-hmm. That's just me wanting to do posters for everyone. I'll tell you what, you know what? See the day that I run my own promotion, right? My posters are going to be fucking banging. Because I'll be in complete control.
That's weirdly not the first conversation I've had in these recent recordings of people setting up shows. Ian Skinner also had an idea of a promotion, which he's probably spoke to you about at some point, because it's just mental in itself.
I'll tell you this, right? Bear Hug Pro, right? That's the name of the show, right? That's the promotion, Bear Hug Pro. My Bear Hug Pro is mental. I have shared like booking ideas with people, and it. You know what? I'm going to give you two, right?
Yeah.
So the gimmick with Bear Hug Pro is, right, every show's got a gimmick, okay? So one idea I've got is like a show based around Squid Game, right?
Okay.
So it's a six-man tag. Whoever takes the pin, boy comes out, shoots them, drags them backstage.
Okay. Right, okay.
Straight into a fatal five-way. Whoever gets pinned, boy comes out, shoots them, drags them backstage. Tag match, triple threat. Then it's the main event, which is the one-on-one match. Both guys get handed a kendo stick and they fight to the death. That's one show. The other show I've got, which could be a series of shows, right? Let's say... So each of these season shows, you would pick a wrestler, right? So let's say I pick Caleb Valhalla, right? The show would be called Caleb's Dream. Okay?
Right.
So, get the ring, get the entranceway, big screen, right? Next to the entranceway, video screen, bed. Caleb comes out, hello, welcomes everyone to the show, gets in bed, goes to sleep. Okay? Little like dream bubbles come above his head on the screen, right? And whatever he's dreaming about, that match happens. Okay, so basically, my idea would be I would book like here you go, Caleb. Here's the wrestlers I booked on the show. Do what you want. And it would be like, you know, he could make fucking, I don't know, he could make Bradley wrestle as Big Show. I don't know. Anyway, you have the whole show. Main event comes out. It's a tag match. Oh no, Caleb's meant to be in the tag. He's asleep. So it's a handicap match. Caleb wakes up. Oh shit. Caleb gets dressed. Okay, at the entranceway. Just in time to take the hot tag. Do the hot tag, go to finish. Every show is just random bullshit while someone sleeps at the entranceway. And then... a hot tag after they wake up, you know, like that dream where someone's not got their boots on.
Mm-hmm.
That's the show.
That was scary. That second one, that was one of Ian's ideas as well. So there's some hive mind stuff going on where, yeah, he said he would get on it was like a stage show, his was, and you go to sleep and then the ring would light up in the middle of the stage and then that would be the show. So that's a bit of a weird hive mind thing going on, unless he's just stolen your ideas that you've relayed. Maybe.
What else? What other ones do I have? I've had a lot of ideas. Because I wanted it to be Bear Hug Pro, but then every show name was like it was a bear pun. So it would be Sun Bear Slam. Or it would be like... Bear at the Beach.
Like we're at the beach. That's not like that one.
I wanted to do, if I was to do a Rumble show, it would be called Teddy Bear's Picnic. What was the other one I had? Tables, Ladders, and Bears.
Ah, there you go. That's...
Hell yeah.
That's it.
So yeah, I want... If I ever run a show, it's either going to be like Scotland's version of Chikara, just complete bullshit, or it'd be a deathmatch show. There's no in between.
It'd be absolute quality.
Go, yeah. Just think about who you could have in a deathmatch. Bruiser Brad Evans in a deathmatch. My goal is to get William Sterling in a deathmatch tournament.
I
think you'd be a cracking deathmatch wrestler. I've said this to him.
I mean, every time I was going, because I go back through like the old Anarchies when I'm in the season of it, and I didn't realize how much William Sterling just absolutely goes balls to the wall at Anarchy. Yeah. I mean, he's ladder matches and all this kind of stuff, and he's always the one that seems to be
like I've said this to him. I think he'd be a cracking deathmatch wrestler. Him versus Bruiser Brad in the semifinals.
Yeah. I'm all in. So speaking of Caleb and his dream, he has also put in a couple questions. He's put name our multiverse tag team.
Yeah, we had the thought that like we've both got like long hair, beards, we've both got like leather jacket things with big shoulder pads, but it'd be like either like a multiverse thing where we're just the same person but from different universes. Or it's like a thing where it's kind of like a multiverse thing, but like he's from like way in the past and I'm from like the post-apocalyptic future, but we've met in the middle.
Okay.
But we need to think of a name. See, that's a difficult one. I don't know, because I've not thought as far as having a name. I just thought we're both the same person from different multiverses. I've been trying to pitch to FCW to do a Caleb Valhalla multiverse angle. But not like me and him are the same guy, but just like he's like this superhero kind of Viking guy. But the multiverse is open and everyone he faces are just big, like, nutcase heavyweights. Just get all these different big heavyweight guys and you just want to fight through all these monsters. That's a great idea.
It's a good idea.
That could be a whole show. That's a show. The Caleb Valhalla multiverse, and he comes out and he does a gauntlet against like 20 monsters and he just gets through them all.
There you go.
Brilliant.
This is all good stuff. Nobody can steal it. This is all Bear Hug Pro and etc. So what I was thinking of, I've totally forgot now. So I'll just move on. He's also asked Skull.
Yeah, he's not quite figured out that I don't drink. That's been a reoccurring theme. There was a couple of promos that were filmed where me and him have interacted and stuff, but they've never ended up being used. So it was just like a thing where other stuff was happening in these backstage promos or vignettes, but like me and him were always like being interrupted. So I think that me and him are being interrupted while he's trying to teach me about Skull, and I'm like, I don't drink alcohol. And he's like, excuse me. But, yeah, Skull.
Remember, but
none of these have ever been used. I don't know.
I remember what I forgot now. When I was speaking to Alan about the Return of Discovery, he was talking about like Back to the Future themed show.
Yes, that would have been great.
Would you have to... I'm assuming you'd possibly have to get new tie-dye gear. Would you?
Are
you
no, up I've for... got it. I've got it over there. You're sitting there. I could wear my debut gear.
Obviously not the Super Executioner, but Happy Hunter. No.
I've got the pink and orange tie-dye with the flares, and then I've got the one that was like pink, white, and red, like swirls. I've got both of them. Because there was only... I'd made a match graphic for that show. I'd made a poster.
I remember that. Yeah, they had the DeLorean, wasn't it?
Yeah. but then I'd made one match graphic, and it was cracking, because it was like, it was the same as a poster, but it had like, this is never going to happen, so it doesn't matter. It was going to be me and Lewis, so it was just our current promo pictures, but then like in a little like box next to our heads was our original promo pictures, and we were going to be those characters. So it was going to be Hippie Horror Aspen Faith versus whatever he was called, fucking Prodigy or whatever he was, when he had like his little jean shorts and his red hair. We were going to do that. It would have been great.
I'm still holding out hope for that, because it sounds just mental.
We would have had Martina would have been Kaza G.
Yeah.
Yeah, it would have been great. I would have loved that.
We've had a DCT and he's David Campbell Thompson.
Yeah.
Laser. There's so many ways that
I thought that would have been a great show. I was like super hyped for that. And then it just never happened. So
we've done that on Caleb. Jeez, there's so many more here. So we've got Deacon Matthews. He's asked, if Grum's knee pads ever absorb a kind of monster on a scale from the guy sat on the toilet in Jurassic Park, or thinking your boat's big enough to hunt Jaws, how screwed are we?
Pretty fucking screwed. Grum's knee pads are the worst thing in the fucking country. I don't know what the fuck he's done to them. He's always like, so I've washed them. In what? He took them out. I'll say this, and this will encapsulate that, and we can move on. He took them out of his bag at training one day, and Alistair Caron walked past and gagged in his mouth. Right. That's all I need to say.
Well, yeah, we'll move on from there. Just to. In general, right. So we've got Scott Leggett, aka at Scotty Swift. He uses his real name on Twitter, so can't really say anything against that. He's put favorite Chris Archer gimmick and why.
Okay. Has Scott gotten into this with you yet? The Chris Archer gimmick thing. Chris Archer had a lot of gimmicks, but it was a lot of gimmicks made up in like my and Scott's head.
No, he didn't. And in our 10 hours of chatting, we have not got to Chris Archer's gimmicks.
So, hello. Hi. Samantha. So he had, when he was first starting, when he debuted and stuff, he had black and white striped tights. And before he'd like debuted on shows or whatever, we knew he had them. And we were convinced that he was going to be called Buzz Hornet. I don't know. That was just, he was going to be Buzz Hornet. And then it never happened. What's another good one? There was I don't know how this one came about, but there was an idea for a gimmick where he'd come out and just be Chris Archer. Just normal, like, young Chris Archer in his stripy tights or whatever. But he would have, like, 1920s like flapper girls with them. They would just be like, whatever he said, they would just be like, oh, Archer, like that was the thing. They would just, you know, they'd be in love with them, and they'd be like doing this in his entrance, and then they would go, oh, Archer. Those are my two favorite ones, Buzz Hornet and oh, Archer. What else did we have? Well, there was one for like a really brief period of time where we wanted them to have an actual like bow and arrow. I don't know where that would go, but O Archer and Buzz Hornet are my favorite ones.
Fair enough. That's probably going to haunt my nightmares tonight. Just that in general. I don't know who's going to play the flapper girls in my.
Oh, no. We'd find someone. We'd find, yeah. I don't know. Like that one time at the. One of the only two over 18 shows WrestleZone did, where the Grand City Hotshots came out with like a stripper. That'll be what it was like.
I could, like, of all the things I can imagine to come out with the Granny City shots, a stripper is fairly low on the list.
Yeah, yeah. That's yeah. We'll get her back, and she can do the oh Archer.
I love that whole concept. It just sounds like, yeah. Oh, we're over the 80s shows. What do we get? Oh, I don't know. We'll get a stripper. Oh, do you
yeah. Do? I don't know.
Love it.
That would have been the last show I went to before I started training, I think.
That was the one that convinced you to
no,
go?
No. I'd went to one show, and I trained for like 2 weeks, and then I went to that over 18 show still as a fan. And then obviously I continued training. But because I remember they did the over 18 show. The main event was William Sterling, Damien and Scotty Swift in a 3-way like death match thing where they had tax and cheese graters and all that pish. And I remember this. So this comes back to how when I said earlier about how I was like an immature little shit or whatever. And like, I think me and Scott would have a better match and stuff now because we're both more in the same sort of mindset. Because there was periods of time where me and Scott like clashed quite a lot, and you know, but I think we're fine now and we chat away and whatever. But I remember there was an after party. So this was in Liquid Nightclub in Aberdeen. You know where Corova is? What's it called now? Bridge Street Social Club. Windmill Bray, right? Where Mashulu was. What's it called? It became Institute anyway afterwards.
Okay, right. I think I'm looking now, yeah.
Liquid was what it was called. That's where they did the over 18 show. But there was an after party upstairs. And I think I'd been training for 2 weeks. And I walked up to Scott and I went, I'm gonna be on shows this time next year. And he went, okay then, we'll see. And then walked away. It's like, but to be fair, within about a week to 2 week period, give or take, I was on shows a year later. So
yeah.
I was right, but I was a dick.
Right, so a couple possible easier ones because I'm realizing the time we've got loads more questions to jam in. I've got Dickie Divers. Who's your favourite heavyweight in the country?
Myself. No, Bruiser Brad. I would have said Crusher, but he's AWOL. Bruiser Brad. Let's say Bruiser Brad.
With yourself as a close second.
Yeah. Cool. Because I can do a moonsault.
Oh, yeah. So if Brad starts throwing in a 450, then...
He did a swanton. He does. Almost killed Crusher. So.
Oh, yeah. Jesus. Yeah. That was...
Because I swantoned him in our match at Discovery. Is that match online yet?
Don't think it is. It's not.
I gave him a swanton at Discovery, and it was like it was perfect. Just hit him just enough, perfect. And he was like, "I'm going to do one." Did one on Crusher, almost killed him. He's like, "I'll never do that again."
I think
if he had done that to Connor would have died.
I think I may be reading Adam's review of it. Brad did a swanton. Fuck that. Yeah, okay, I got a bit.
If Connor had taken that, Connor would have died. I've got no doubt about that.
Speaking of almost dying, Emily Hayden has asked, ask him about the time we almost died.
Ugh, this is a long one. This is a long one.
Is this the same car journey with Benny? Because if it is Benny, then it's not. Benny, Big Benny. Is it Benny? But. Yeah, so if Emily's now in two stories where they almost die, I'm starting to think she's the jinx in all this.
So I'm trying to think what I can say without being a dick to people. So the shorter version of it is we were both booked somewhere down south. We had a hotel, which ended up being what I can only describe as a junky halfway house. Like, this is the kind of place that I imagine people go, like, when they're, like, going to rehab, or if they're, like, an asylum seeker, they just need somewhere for a couple of days or something. It was that kind of a place. Near reception. There was a tuck shop near reception, though. The reviews before we got there, they were all like 1-star reviews saying that they had no water for a week and whatever. The description of the place said it had an outdoor patio area, which was about like a 2-meter square of astroturf and then a palm tree with no leaves. There was blood on the towels. There were smashed windows. The car park was... the car park looked like it was like... It looked like a building had just been demolished there and then it had been pushed to the side. Yeah, that was a hotel. It was just weird. There is a longer version of this, but that's the gist of it. We thought we were going to a place where we might die and be murdered. And luckily we survived.
I didn't expect, I thought it was just going to be in our car journey, another car possible crash kind of situation. But no, that sounds fucking terrifying.
No. Also, Stephen Miles was with me, and he spent most of the weekend in that hotel room showing me pictures of other hotels he'd been to. And he was like, I'm used to 4-star hotels. Because he's a wee posh lad. Yeah.
That's just what you need in a shiter of a hotel, is go and look at this one.
Yeah. But he was doing it out of, like, distress. He was, like, showing me what he's used to, and I was like, I don't know what you want me to do.
Bother in your sleep? I don't know. Oh, good to hear. We've got Adam. Nice quick one, I think. Adam asking, if Young Bucks ever came back to Discovery, how much convincing would James Midas need to return?
Probably quite a lot. I've tried before. I've tried to get him back. I tried to get him to be the King's Catchers manager at one point. Don't think it's going to happen.
No, so I mean, Damien had his daughter. Zach had the foundation. There should have been Midas there, but no, you came in Aspen no mates after spending the whole of your WrestleZone career being a bastard. So, but no pals.
Yes, my own fault.
Right, so the last one I've got through the Twitter is through the Jericho, Stevie Wizard. He is asked, Johnny Hollywood, discuss.
Okay. This could be a long one as well. We'll just go through the whole fucking thing. Northern Tour. It was the Northern Tour that I was wrestling Divers. Were you at that one? I wrestled Divers all that weekend. Apart from the last day. I wrestled Divers all weekend, and I wrestled him 4 times in 3 days, and each match ended with a different attitude or finish. I took a choke slam, a pedigree, a rock bottom, and a stunner. It was the show that... No, you... Yes, you were at that one.
Yeah.
It was the show that... I wrestled Divers. This is just killing kayfabe, because every show was the same that whole weekend. But I wrestled Divers. Luke Aldridge and Taylor Bryden did a run-in to help him win. And then it was them three versus me, Musso, and Nathan Reynolds in the main.
Right. Yeah.
The show you were at, Luke Aldridge was the Bulgarian baker for some reason, because you were there.
Yeah, yeah, probably. That's
yes, so that weekend. So they did a show in Wick, I think it was. I think it was in Wick. So we turned up. And so that was the tour that had, it was me, Divers, Debbie was on it. I think she was wrestling.
Emily?
Was it? It was either Emily.
Match that. I don't know. I think that was an hour tour. They had a match because
I feel like it was Leah Owens.
Oh yeah, she had the mask.
Yes.
Yes.
So yeah. So that's everyone was there. So we turn up to the Wick one, and it's maybe me and Divers. We've planned the match two shows ago, so we know what we're doing. We just know that the finish is now a stunner instead of a rock bottom. And then Musso comes up and he's like, this guy's going to be in your match. He's called Johnny Hollywood. And we're like, who? And apparently he, from what I could figure out, he'd trained at Keith Ness for a bit, but he was shite. So he was gone. And then I believe he went and did some stuff for SSW. So good track record already. Oh, yeah. So I'm like, right, okay, because apparently this guy, he's from Wick. So he said that he could sell tickets, bring his mates or whatever. So Musso was like, right, cool, we'll put you on the show if you bring your mates or whatever. Great. So he put him in our match. So we're like, we planned our match 2 days ago. Can we just, I don't want to plan another match. So Johnny Hollywood's there, whatever. How can I explain this? So I heard him say to Musso, so Mike, how do I go about planning a match? Right? I heard that like out of earshot, and I was like, Divers, what the fuck are we doing? So whatever, we left him for a bit while we're getting changed or whatever, and we look over and he's getting dressed, and he's got, right, I'll describe him from the ground up. Okay, I'm gonna build you know WCW Mayhem, the game.
Mm-hmm.
You know the intro sequence where they build Goldberg, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm doing this with Johnny Hollywood. So he's got white, like high top Lonsdale boots, okay? With like the toes almost worn all the way through. Like you're almost like, they're almost see through at the front. You can see his toes. Then he's got women's like zebra print Primark leggings, right? Kind of Ronan King style, now that I think about it. But they were like black with like zebra print down the side. And we realized that Debbie owned the same ones, which was fucking hilarious. So he's got that, okay? Then he's got a weightlifting belt, like Hogan style, okay?
Right.
Then he's got, weightlifting gloves, okay? And he's got, electrical tape. He's got a Mr. T style, like, big chains, okay? He's got tassels around his arms and like around his boots, but he's made them himself out of like shoelaces, and they've still got little plastic bits on the end, like the shoelace bits. And he's got a headband on, like a bandana thing. And we're just fucking looking at him like, holy fuck. And then he puts on this big furry jacket and shades. And he looks at me in Divers and he goes, what do you think of the jacket? My missus says it's a bit too much. And we're like, just go with it. Just do it. Just wear it. Cool, okay. So then someone comes and asks him what music he wants. And he goes, just give me something like hair metal sort of music. And we're like, all right, whatever. So they go away. So we speak to them, we plan a match. Like, just go away, have a think, whatever. We basically just did the match we were doing anyway, but we, at points, like, I got thrown out and then Divers did a bit with them and whatever. So he goes away and we're just sitting chatting. And then he comes back up and he goes, okay, so, I'm going to do this to you and do this to you, blah, blah, blah. And then Divers just looks at him and goes, that isn't anything that we've said. I don't know what this match you've said is. This is not anything we've planned. And he said, oh, what was it again? So we go over it again. So while we're planning it, I go to him. So what sort of moves do you do? He goes, I do this thing where you clothesline me and I go backwards out the ring. And I was like, so your move is me clotheslining you out of the ring. And he was like, yeah. I was like, right, well, do you go to the apron? Like, you land on the apron or do you go all the way to the floor? He went, I don't know. I goes, well, could you go to the floor? Yeah. Okay, cool. There was a bit where we were going to double tackle him. And he goes to us, see me do the double tackle? You both on the same side, yeah? And my mind's never been able to comprehend what that would be. So we're going to tackle them both on the same side. So show's going on or whatever. And we're like, right, we'll go over it again just before we go out, just to make sure you got it. all he had was like, I think he was in body slam Divers at one point, and he had to cut me off with a forearm and throw me out of the ring or whatever. So we were waiting to go out. And he goes, oh, by the way, guys, if I hit you for real, it just happens sometimes. And with that, Divers music plays and he goes to the ring. And I'm just like, what the fuck? My music plays, I go to the ring. We're in the ring waiting for hair metal music to play. And then the Mexican hat dance starts playing. You know, like, and we're just like, what the fuck? And then this boy runs backwards out the entranceway like Enzo More, right? And by the way, we'd got to the ring at this point and realized there's like 20 people in the crowd and he brought one person. So he's just run out backwards, Enzo More style, completely no-sold the fact that he's coming out to the Mexican hat dance, just like fully like Mr. T'd up with his chains and stuff. We get in the ring and we're just like, right, okay. So the bell rings. I can send you this match. By the way, I've got it on my YouTube. It's the funniest thing you'll ever watch. It's a private video, but it's got like a ridiculous amount of views. It must have just been like said about, but whatever. So we start the match, and what's meant to happen is Divers is being like the heel. He goes away or whatever. He's like, I'm not having this. And then me and Hollywood are meant to like trade until Divers jumps him. We double send, double tackle, clothesline over the top. He goes to the floor. Leave me and Divers to the start of our match that we had planned anyway. What actually happened was, me and Divers, fucking heaven forbid, tried to do some crowd work and went off the script slightly. And we're like interacting with the crowd and I'm trying to get them to come up. And Divers is like, shut up, whatever. And he's like agitated because he knows he's meant to be doing something with me, but we're doing something else. And he's like, you can see him. And then he just like hits me for real in the face. And I'm like, oh. And then he hits me for real again. So I give him like one of the hardest forearms I've ever done in my life. And then he hits me for real again. And Divers, see, it just happens sometimes. So now we're really like hitting each other. I don't know if I'm doing it on purpose because he's hitting me on purpose. Well, he's hitting me really hard for real, and I'm hitting him on purpose back. And Divers now sees this. So Divers comes up behind, and Divers like clobbers him in the back. We go to send him off. We give him the double tackle, and he just evaporates to the floor. He feeds up the ropes. Now, can you take a clothesline to the floor? Yeah. Clothesline him. His arms get tangled on the ropes, and he's now kneeling on the apron with his arms like this on the ropes. I'm like, for fuck's sake. And he stands up, and I just, like, at this point, I was like, I don't know who the fuck this boy is. Fuck this. And I just slap him across the face, and he goes down to the floor. Me and Divers do whatever we're doing. It's fine. And at some point, Divers is in the corner. I'm going to charge him, and then Hollywood's meant to, like, as I'm running, he's meant to just, like, jump me and then throw me out of the ring. And then him and Divers do a battle. So he jumps me in the most awkward way ever, and I'm, like, caught up in the ropes, and he tries to throw me out, and I just, like, fucking die on the apron, and I'm on the floor now. He does a bit with Divers. He body slams Divers onto his side. So he's obviously getting annoyed. He body slammed Divers on his side. I think Divers gave him a drop kick, like, right in the fucking face. I get in, get rid of Divers, and then me and him are going to run a bit. So I send him off, and I go, take the clothesline, and he ducks it. And I'm like, motherfucker. So I just turn around, and I just kick him square in the fucking balls. And then I grab him, and I give him an X-plex, and he shits himself in the middle of the air. Divers comes back in, does a bit with him, where it's meant to be, he sends Divers, Divers reverses it, he hits the buckle. As he comes out of the buckle, he takes a super kick from Divers. Now, he'd been annoying the whole day, and when he asked Divers how to take a super kick, Divers went, just keep running. So he did. And it's the most real super kick I've ever seen in my life. And he's just lying there like this on the mat. Right? And then we go to a finish. We had 20 minutes for this match. Okay? And when I fucking tell you, the finish was a stunner. And the video ends at 3 minutes 16 seconds.
How did that all happen in 3 minutes?
Wait. 3 minutes 16 seconds, right? We did a whole match in 3 minutes and just went backstage, and Moose was like, you went 17 minutes under. Like, sorry. And yeah, the guy came up and was like, how was that? And we were just like, don't, please don't. But I got the footage of it, and it's fucking hilarious. And yeah, that's Johnny Hollywood. See if you actually hold on. I'm gonna find a photo of him.
I was gonna say, because I seem to like recognize his attire, and if it was someone who wrestled in UPW when they came in the Northeast, I wouldn't be shocked.
I wouldn't be shocked, but
because he wrestled in Converse, and I hate that, as Omar learned.
What was he wearing? Converse. He wasn't wearing a Converse when he wrestled us.
All right.
He was definitely wearing high top, like white Lonsdale boots.
Right. Okay. So it probably is a different guy, but the whole look and description.
I googled Johnny Hollywood wrestler, and the first thing that came up is a Sun article that says Scots wrestler Johnny Hollywood grappled with dyslexia. Let's see if there's any photos of him wrestling in this.
Oh, here we go. Scots wrestler Johnny.
Yes, there is. If you scroll down on that article, right, he's got tie-dye tights in this picture. But he's still got his wee tassels. There you go. I'll hold this up. I don't know if that is... There you go. There's Johnny Hollywood. What a guy.
Wow.
So, yeah. That was... That was me and Diver's 3-minute epic. Mate, Stunner, 1, 2, 3, 3 minutes, 16 seconds. Can't get better than that.
6'2" and 18 stone, Johnny Hollywood. I don't know. Sometimes I go through like just trying to find some news and that, and I've seen this article way too recently for it to be a coincidence. But yeah, there we go. Oh, that's just cruel. Right stuff. Scottish wrestler Johnny Hollywood grappled with dyslexia to pen his first book. That just seems a cruel tagline to put in there. Anyway, right. This isn't about Johnny Hollywood, but wow, I was not. Same with the Emily Hayden dying story. Was not expecting it to go like that. But 3:16. I don't know how that is. I can't wait to watch this.
I'll send you the match. It's fantastic.
I can't believe that's been all condensed into three. It took you longer to tell me about it than the match actually was.
Yeah.
Right. So that's all the Twitter ones. So that's all the ones you would have seen. We've got loads. We've got 6 on Instagram to do. So we're good time.
We'll be all right.
Yeah. So we've got Grant McIver asking, favourite fruit pastel colour?
Red.
That's the best one.
Second best one's blackcurrant, which is great that they've brought out them bags of just the blackcurrant and strawberry ones.
I like green, I like the lime ones.
It's all right. I like them all, but those two are the best ones.
I'm not a big fan of blackcurrant. That's why if we do get a pack of that in the house or something, because I do the pouches of them as well, then I'll just do my best to get all the red ones.
Red are the best.
Right. We've got Tom Humphreys. AKA Tom Atlas, asking the 2 foot. Well, I just put the 2 foot of doom.
Oh, do you want to see it?
Go for it.
I wrestled him at a gala last week, 2 weeks ago. I got like ridiculously sunburned, and it's like in the line of my singlet as well. I was beating him up, and then a kid in the crowd shouted 2 foot of him, and I was like, okay. So I just ran across the ring and I gave him a 2 foot tackle. And it's one of the better things to see if I can get this. Oh, I'm gonna have to press the play button. Ready? Can you see it?
Yeah, we can see it.
Bam!
Holy shit. that is beautiful.
The kid just shouted 2 foot room, so I was like, okay, gotta give the crowd what they want.
Basically, it's not. I mean, usually when you're at galas, it's just RKO, isn't it? Or used to be Stunner.
You had to save that for the main event.
Of course. We've got Ian Skinner. He's got quite a few in here. He's put favorite AEW Suzuki match.
I don't know what ones I've seen. Name them.
Oh Jesus! I'm not going to help me. I travel to watch AEW.
He wrestled Danielson, didn't he?
Yes, that was the one. I think so. That's what just like slap each other for a good while.
Yeah, I've definitely seen that one. So that one.
Okay, fair. But no,
I've not watched a lot of AEW other than pay per views. So
I can't get into it. It's just not for me. I'll keep trying, but it's just not for me. Give me the cartoon characters. I'm quite happy with that. Ian Skinner's also asked, why the headband if it doesn't keep hair out of your eyes?
It's just a throwback to when I was doing the hippie thing. When I was trying to come up with my look and stuff, I was looking at pictures of like people at Woodstock and stuff, and there was a lot of hippie with like thin little or like bits of string they just tied around there to like keep their hair down. So it's just that. It's just a throwback to when I was doing the hippie gimmick, and I've just kept it because I feel naked without it now, unless I've got my hair just tied up like this. Mm-hmm. If I've got my hair braided, I need something there. It just, I don't know, feels weird.
I've always appreciated it when I'm trying to like make in one of the 2K games, because that's usually like if I try to get a face scan in, it usually just breaks around about there, and I can just put the black band over top of it so it covers it. It's great.
They don't have my hair in it though.
No, never. I have to go just for a long hair look.
I used to make creative wrestlers, but like years, like way before I was a wrestler, like you know, here comes the pain and stuff. Mm-hmm. And that was the hairstyle that I picked. That's why I started doing my hair like that in my first match, because that was the character I created. Because they used to have the braids, and you know, it was a side part here with the braids, and that's what I did. I made my character like that, and then they took it out of the game, and I was very disappointed.
I know, they've just got like a shit one where it's like
they're way too long, or they're big thick things,
or you get a fringe to go with it.
Yeah, it's just not happy.
I'm not enjoying this year's creative. I don't have
the game.
I made so many last year, and then of course I had to delete half of them because there were.
I've not bought it just because I bought the last three, and then I went in the game, made myself, played one game, and then it never went back in the PlayStation. So I've just not bothered with this one. Apparently, it's better, but
it's fine. Yeah, I'm still in that. For some reason, the only things I play now on the PS4, because I'm still poor. I've got a PS4. Is 2K22 sometimes. I'm really playing Ape Escape 2 at the moment. That seems to be my jam. And Fortnite, which I haven't been playing it as much recently. It's just they could have me as much this season, but I kind of want to get Indiana Jones though, so I might come back to it just to do those.
I'm pretty much playing it right now to get Darth Vader.
Yeah. I mean, I thought we'd have like grind it last time to get Doctor Strange, but no, I just fell away. Just not playing it.
I didn't play it for most of last season, and then like the last 2 weeks I was like, my completionist inside me won't let this season end without me having everything, so I've got to level 200 in 2 weeks by just grinding, because I needed to unlock everything. I just can't do it. I was like, oh, I'll never use the skins. I still had to. I can.
I know. I was the same for the season before. I was like, right, I want to get Spider-Man. I want to get Spider-Man because I love Spider-Man.
You had to unlock every Spider-Man skin.
Yeah, and I did that. But yeah, I still use the one that they put onto the store for the film. So that's the one I used. And I was like, I spent all my time unlocking these. Yeah. I don't use them.
So I'm trying to find another game to play, but I just can't get into anything. Like the last new game I played was Forbidden West. Horizon Forbidden West, which I really enjoyed. But other than that, I keep trying to play games and I'm like, So I did another playthrough of Fallout 4 and then Outer Worlds, and now I'm like, I can't be arsed playing anything else, but I don't want to go back and play them again because I've just completed them, so it's too fresh in my head, and I don't know what I'm going to do.
Yeah, I had that during the pandemic. I went through all the Uncharted games again and played them and really enjoyed them. I kind of want to get Spider-Man, but I'm not paying. I don't want to buy games anything under a tenner. That's probably my limit now for games, because I don't play them enough to necessitate paying too much for them. And 2K22, I bought brand new and I barely play it. So I'm like, no, nothing.
I was a complete, like, I don't really, the only ones I ever buy are secondhand ones, or, you know, like, go to CEX and it's a couple of years old or whatever. But I got Forbidden West when it came out because I really liked the first one. But I like pre-ordered it, and then when I pre-ordered it and pre-downloaded it. So when the little padlock disappeared at midnight, I was like, here we go, straight into the game.
But yeah, it's just finding time. That's the other thing, and
yeah,
it's just and we're gonna find even less of it soon. So I'm just gonna I've got a wee list of WWE Network stuff to kind of watch when I have to stay up through the night, and I've got all the broken. I haven't watched any of the recent Broken Skull sessions, so I've got them all kind of ready to go. But no, I'll find time again. But no, I enjoyed. It was after our last chat that I started playing Fortnite. Because you kind of convinced me. I think I spoke to Zach as well, and he was speaking about it. So I was like, oh, fuck it, why not? And then end up.
It gets shit on a lot, but it's actually I enjoy playing it with, like, I'll just like mute the telly and I'll put on like a podcast or like a show or something, and then I just might mindlessly play it while I'm watching.
Yeah, that's how I was doing it, and I enjoyed the fun aspect of just me coming into a group of yous and me just dying and automatically at the start, and then just watching everyone else.
Yeah.
Because still the case. I've won some, but I think I've only like four wins.
I had the best win I've ever had in my life yesterday. Sammy was playing with Bradley, and then she went away, so I just took over, and it was like one of those ones where Bradley's died like really near the end. There's like three other people and I'm the only one left. And I'm like, I'm going to die here. And I had like barely any health. And I was like, this is my like last hurrah. This is my last ditch effort. So, you know, the like the new trees they added that you can knock over and they fall down.
Mm-hmm.
I just shot two of them and they fell on the guys and killed them and won the game. And I was like, holy fuck. That was the best thing I've ever done.
Oh man, well, my favorite win was first one I ran as Captain America. Of course, did it was like start of a season, and I was like down to the final three, and I was so excited because like, oh my god, I never get this far, and then suddenly it gave me the crown, and I'd won. Fuck knows what happened. I don't know what happened.
Yeah,
I hid behind something, and suddenly I won it, and I was like, if that happened, all of them, that'd be ace.
Yeah,
but another time I just hid in a car. And started pot shotting people. I felt like a dick, but it was the most satisfying thing I did. Had a wee sniper and just watched them run past and just go,
that's what you want.
There you go. One more question from Ian, which I think you kind of answered a little bit or teased to, but we've got, when is the tie dye coming back?
I might wear it on Saturday. I've got a gala. That could be my gala. That would be my house show tights. You remember like Kenny Omega when he was wearing the cool like black leather tights and stuff, but then he had his house show tights on like small shows. He'd wear the like pink ones with the tassels. Maybe I'll just make the tie-dye ones. That's my house show tights. They're like my galas and like birthday party shows and stuff.
Why not? And the final question we've got from all of this is from unknown Emerson_Jane.
Fantastic.
Nice, simple one. What do you love about me the most?
That you sometimes wrestle in other countries and I get peace for a couple of days.
Fair.
I think that's a good answer.
I think so. So that's all the questions, and I think we've just about covered all your wrestling from the last year as well. We haven't really talked about Reckless. How you finding just getting into the swing of things again, like the training and the seminars and the just keeping yourself busy?
Yeah, I think it's weird, like try to train people when I still feel like I don't know what the fuck I'm doing, but I must to some extent, you know what I mean? But I'm not a fan of like the going in and getting people to do drills, and I fucking hate that shit, like, but obviously it needs to be done to like get people going over stuff to practice it, but like I enjoy more of the like this psychology storytelling side of it, like, you know, try to get people thinking and being creative, understanding why things are done a certain way and that sort of stuff. I enjoy that sort of aspect of it. I don't know. I don't feel like I'm the person that should be in charge of a class of people, because I don't feel like I have a fucking clue what I'm doing in half my matches, but
yeah. Why not? Yeah, I guess that's about it. So I can't remember if we brought in I asked you about the dinosaur, what your favorite dinosaur was.
Yeah.
Must have done. I can't remember, was that point, was the two sheep, one cow question?
It was. The dinosaur was a pteranodon, but we weren't sure if it counted as a dinosaur because it was one of the flying ones.
I think the ship has sailed on fictional and non-fiction dinosaurs, so you can have that one.
I think we did the sheep and cow one. I think it definitely wasn't cow. I think it was between the sheep, because like Aberdeen,
mm-hmm.
or like a run-in from a pig.
That seems familiar. Yeah, that does seem familiar now, that there was a run involved somewhere.
I've literally right now just got a question from Debbie.
Oh.
In reply to my story.
All right, okay.
She said, would you rather have hands for feet or feet for hands? hands for feet.
Yeah.
Definitely. 100%. Because I can put them in a shoe and hide them. So you wouldn't see them. But it opens up all these possibilities for like stuff that monkeys can do. You know, like hanging on to stuff with my feet hands. You got all this stuff you could maybe do in a match with your little feet hands as well.
And you can just like pick up stuff off the coffee table or that. You don't need to bend.
I've got quite nimble feet, so I could pick stuff up with my toes anyway. Definitely.
I'm not going to ask for a demonstration.
No, that's okay. But definitely hands for feet.
I mean, it depends what you do. If you're like an OnlyFans model and you're selling feet pics, I mean, 4 feet. It would definitely be hands for feet. I'm fully agreement with that. So the last question then, we have aced this time wise. I'm quite chuffed with that. Vince McMahon's phoned you. This is a fancy question to round up the show. So Vince McMahon's phoned you. He said, "I've seen your work. Some guy keeps calling you the Lost Boy when you're clearly Lost Boy Aspen Faith. I want to put you in the main event of WrestleMania. I want to give you absolute creative control. You can pick your opponent as long as they're alive. Pick your opponent, pick the stipulation. It could be anything, tag match, battle royal, any opponents, any number of opponents you wish. Your full charge. What is it?"
Okay. It's the main event of WrestleMania.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Picture. Okay. Main event, WrestleMania. We're in some arena. I don't know. In my head, it's an open top arena, but it's nighttime, so it's dark. Okay. Cool entranceway, bed. Okay. I'm in the bed. Okay. In the ring, you got a tag match. Okay. It's going to be Steve Austin, okay, this is his last hurrah, okay, his last hurrah is Aspen's dream, Steve Austin, then the opposite side of the ring is Vince McMahon and Linda McMahon, okay, so they're like Vince is like getting on Steve, but Linda's sitting in the corner in a wheelchair. So you have the match. Steve Austin's getting beaten down. I wake up. Oh shit! I'm at Mania. I got my boots on. I get my boots on. I run down the fucking giant ramp. Hot tag. In I come. Vince immediately kicks me in the balls. Oh no! I'm dying. He's loving it. Heat. Linda McMahon stands up, big pop. He turns around, Linda kicks him in the balls. He takes a terrible stunner off of Steve Austin. Steve looks at me and he goes, "You take the pin, kid." And I'm like, "Cool." And I cover him 1, 2, 3. And then we have a beer bash, but he gives me a monster.
I don't think anything will top that, so it's probably a good way to end the show.
Okay.
I'm so glad we brought the dream came back into the episode somehow of this. This is wonderful. Right. I'll leave that with everyone's fever dream of Johnny Hollywood and then obviously Aspen's dream. Where can people find you, Bear Hug? Plug all your shit.
Everything is the Aspen Faith, so at the Aspen Faith or slash the Aspen Faith, it's all the same. In all my bios, I've got a link tree which has got all my merch, and it has a link to the Bear Hug design folio and all that good stuff.
Excellent. Well, perfect. Thanks for joining me today.